Hi, everybody, and welcome to the show. JeremyCordeaux.com around the world from the dining room table, and I'll be with you right through until midday today. Give us a call if you'd like to. We're all set to go, aren't we? Tony? Liz? Yeah, we are. 0491 65 68 60 is the telephone number that you should be dialing. So if you want to get it off your chest and on the air, that's the simplest thing to do. And that number, by the way, if you phone us, is okay, or you can text us as well. JeremyCordeaux.com, your global radio station. So wherever you are listening, feel free. I can't say reverse the charges, can I, Tony?
We don't want to do that.
No, we don't want to do that. No. But wherever you are, if you want to just call us up for the novelty of it, 0491 65 68 60. We're broadcasting to you from Adelaide, South Australia. It's a lovely, lovely town of about, I don't know, what is it, about 1.3 million, 1.4?
Not sure if we've quite got that far yet. But
Liz Elikas has joined us.
Yeah, good morning, everyone.
Yeah,
it's
not
draw the boundary, doesn't it?
Yeah, well, it's a nice, compact little city, really. Speaking of sizes,
it was.
It's spreading, it's growing. But speaking of cities, I saw this morning that the largest democracy in the world is about to go to the people. Now, I'm talking about India, with, I think, 1.4 billion people. Number of eligible voters, something like 964 million. 964 million. You imagine counting 964 million votes.
Good job for a scrutineer.
Yeah, what would happen if you lost count? You know,
start again.
Yeah. You'd have to start again, for God's sake. You would. Hello? Hello?
Good morning, Jeremy.
Oh, John.
How are you?
I'm very well indeed. And you?
Not bad, thank you.
Excellent.
Got a couple of topics I'd like to raise with you this morning.
Sure.
First one is the ever-going saga of the Brittany Higgins, Bruce Lehman factor. What did you think of the judgment of the judge?
Well, he took I'm sure judges are used to taking responsibility, but, you know, when you've got a case like that, which is what always worried me, it was a he said, she said sort of situation. There was no forensic evidence. There were no witnesses. And there were troubling things, such as Brittany not reporting the incident. And when she did report the incident 12 months later or whatever it was to the media, not the police.
Yeah.
The judge has it's his opinion, but it's only one man's opinion. It's a learned opinion. But he had a different sort of set of guidelines. It wasn't beyond reasonable doubt, because I don't think you could have convicted anybody on a case like that and give the accused benefit of the doubt. Of course it's got to be doubt. How are you possibly going to prove it? But he had a different sort of slant on justice, in that it was the probability. It was, you know, a judgment that it probably happened. And that was his judgment. But as I said, it's only one man.
Exactly. And the thing is, he has actually sort of passed judgment on the chap, even though it's under the word of probability that it happened. But what about the man's actual truth? If he says he didn't do it, where's the guidelines to sort of? I know that the judge said that he told a few untruths during the course of the thing, but you know, if you knew you'd done it, you would have had to own up. Like, the thing I find with Bruce Lehman, he fronted court every day. He didn't have his head hung down and looking at his shoelaces. He looked straight out to where, you know, the judge was and the jury. And if you are not guilty, like, you know, there is a thing that, you know, the truth does stand on its own.
Yeah, well, he, as the judge said, he was out of the lion's den and went back for his hat, which is a good line, but the logic to me is that if you were innocent, you would be there trying to clear your name and all of that sort of thing. And if you were guilty, you would, wouldn't you? You'd say, "Well, I'm out of the jaws of the law. I'm not going to poke the bear. I'll just go on my merry way." But to go back in and have a trial before a judge, knowing that it was the probability that he would be looking at, was, if you were guilty, it would be a pretty stupid thing, wouldn't it?
Because yeah, well, that's... I just think the man just wants his name. He doesn't want that accusation against his name.
Well, I don't know what he does now.
Well,
no,
the trouble is, John, that the judgment, if you read all the detail, the judge has actually said there's a great deal of untruthfulness by all parties. So no one's totally innocent in all this in many respects, and... What balance of probability means to one person can mean something completely different to someone else, because one could argue the balance of probability is that he didn't do it. And I look at the vision when these two people entered Parliament House. Brittany seemed to be very frolicsome. She was capable on her feet. I mean, like, I'm not making a judgment one way or the other myself, but I sort of look at the vision and I say, well, these were two people... I mean, after a few drinks, they're consenting adults, and who knows what really happened? No one knows really actually what happens, and my view on the whole thing is that security shouldn't have allowed these people into the Parliament House. And that hasn't been an issue. That hasn't been an issue, and I think that should have been an issue from the start.
It should have too. Who's the gentleman that I'm this with is, you, Jeremy?
Les Elikas.
Les Elikas. Well, Les... Yeah, I incline to agree with it. The security should have been on them before they were allowed. Like, that was a workplace. They shouldn't have been there at that hour of the morning. That's my personal opinion.
Yeah, well, when you think about it, these two young people, they were in, I think, pretty responsible jobs, advising ministers of the Crown, you know, advising or being their media consultant. Now, you would imagine that this... young lady would have sort of thought twice about putting herself in a situation where maybe she was vulnerable. You know, I'm not saying you wander through life expecting the worst of people, but you just don't put yourself in harm's way. And why would you go back, knowing you'd had a lot to drink, why would you go back into a situation where if something did happen, it would be difficult to call for help?
Yeah.
Mind you, I don't know how far away the Minister for Defence's office is from the security people, whether she could have called out. There's no evidence there that she, struggled or complained or argued or yelled for help. I don't know whether help would have been close to hand, but as I said on that morning that I got the sack, I just simply said the silly girl got drunk and should take responsibility for her behaviour, and I still stand by that. Young people...
Well, she should have, Jeremy. She was over 21, you know.
Sure.
And you know, from 21 you're supposed to take responsibility for any of your actions that you get involved in.
And John, look, we as taxpayers, we forked out $2.4 million, and I think there'd be a reasonable case... for a significant inquiry, and particularly asking Richard Dreyfuss, why would he fast-track that payment of $2.4 million? I mean, there should have been a fairly significant inquiry if you're handing out taxpayers' money like that. And a lot of people, and Matt Canavan, he's actually from the Nationals, and made the comment last night on Sky that, you know, you've got people laying their lives on the line, veterans, who wouldn't get payouts like that for... you know, putting their neck on the chopping block.
But has anyone gone into print or publicly stated why the money was handed over in the first place?
No.
Oh, no. Oh, seems no. strange to me.
And how can you hand money when there was no definite penalty, like, you know, a definite action against the man, like that he was found guilty?
No.
Katie Gallagher put up the... the $2.4 million, and it got passed, you know.
Well, I don't know. They've yet to explain it.
Yeah. Here's my second point. If you're voted into a party, and I'm referring to the chap up in the Adelaide Hills, Dan Cregan, and then you decide that you don't like the way your party's going, if you decide that you don't want to be there, to me, you should resign and then call a by-election up
yeah.
there to...
Yeah, but you're elected representing a certain party, and you don't know whether the votes that came to you were for you or for the party. But one way or the other, to clean it up, the simplest thing is to sort of stand down altogether.
Well, I have heard on another station this morning that he's actually written a letter as the new police minister to all his constituents in the area, stating that he's not going to be leaning either to the Labor Party or the Liberal Party.
Huh.
He's going to act as a definite independent.
Yeah, well, he wasn't elected as an independent. I think that's the point you're making, and I think it's a very valid one.
Well, it is, Jeremy, you know, because a lot of people might not have voted for him if they said he was going to stand as an independent.
Yeah, well, right.
I think the other point, too, is some of these rules need to be tightened up. It's like politicians who stand for re-election get re-elected, and then 5 minutes later they say they're going to pull the pin, forcing a by-election, costing, again, the taxpayer more money.
Mm.
I mean, I think if people get elected, it's their responsibility to stay in the job. Or if you're not going to stay in the job, don't stand for office.
Yeah, that's a good point, Les, and that's what should happen. If he didn't want to stay there, he should have stepped straight out of it and said, I'm out, you know.
Mm. Well, it's like
anyway, I'll let you get on with the show.
All righty, John.
Thanks for listening to me, and I hope you get many calls on it, because I do think it's an issue that needs to be resolved.
Good to talk to you.
Oh, two lovers parked on a lover's lane. Just a watching the stars above. They don't have to say a thing. They're speaking the language of love. Ooby dooby dooby doo. Ooby dooby dooby doo. Ooby dooby 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 doo doo. Dooby doo 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 doo. Oh, two lovers sipping on a chocolate shake. You can tell what they're thinking of. Their eyes are saying little secret things. They're using the language of love. Ooby dooby dooby doo. Ooby dooby dooby doo. Ooby dooby 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 doo doo. Dooby doo doo. Speaking of, ain't learned no English, but they're learning fast. The language of love. Ooby dooby dooby doo. Ooby dooby dooby doo. Ooby dooby 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 doo doo. Dooby doo doo. Ooby dooby 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 doo doo. Dooby doo doo. Ooby dooby 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 doo.
0491 65 68 60 if you would like to ring us. Maria.
Good morning, all. How are you?
Well, wonderfully well.
Yeah, that's good. Continuing on from John, that show is like the ABC. It's biased to the truth. They seen a gotcha moment and they went for it.
What show?
The Project.
Oh, The Project. Well, look,
yes.
I think they're blatantly a left-wing presentation. I don't know. I guess they just thought to themselves, the news, what is their slogan? The news presented differently?
Yeah, it sure is different. Now, she got them into government. That's why the payment was the reward, Jeremy.
No, they were already in government.
Yeah.
Well, what you mean is the suggestion, the allegation you're making is that before the election they were looking to prove or demonstrate that the Liberals had what they described as a problem with women.
Yes.
And they decided that this would be a very good kind of stalking horse to push that case forward. Well, look, I don't know. I mean, it could have. politics is politics, and it's dirty.
On the balance of probability, yes.
Yeah. Now,
if it looks like a duck and walks like a duck, it's usually a duck.
It is a duck.
Yeah.
Now, in regards to the case, there is another point that has been missed. The establishment that was serving the drinks should have their license revoked. Where is the responsible service of alcohol where you should be only serving two standard drinks per day? And that does not happen across the board in Australia. It may be different over there, but, you know, if an establishment sees that everyone is on their ear, they should be stopping serving of alcohol.
Yeah, well, it's different. It's different in Canberra, and I don't know that it's meant to be different in Canberra, but that's why they call it the bubble. You know, people go there and they're normal and fairly straight-laced, I suspect, and then they find themselves in this different environment called Canberra.
Look, in most jurisdictions, Maria, I've spent my life in the hospitality industry, and under most jurisdictions, you're not permitted to serve intoxicated patrons. But it's rarely enforced.
Well, that's a problem, isn't it?
Yeah. Do you remember?
That's a problem
Maria, do you remember Janine Haynes?
Yes, I do.
Well, years ago, and I was talking to Les about this a little bit earlier, years ago, must be 30 years or more, Janine Haynes was just a brand new senator in Canberra. And I can't remember whether she was just a new senator or she had become the head of the Democrats, head of the party.
Yeah.
But I rang her, had cause to ring her. Wasn't on a specific thing. I wanted to find out what it was like, what she thought of Canberra and how did she like the new job and all that sort of stuff. And I asked her if there was anything that sort of stood out as being particularly noteworthy or interesting. And she said, the thing about Canberra is all this bed hopping. You know, it's amazing. These people have no morals. And I tell you what, the world erupted. The cartoonist had a field day. It was on the front page. It was on the front page of the Advertiser, and I think page 2 of the Australian. And people were saying, I know the bed hopping goes on, but certainly not me. No, it's not me. No. It was a fascinating.
It's over there.
Yeah, a fascinating example of people in denial, but people being caught. And having this, you know, wide-eyed, very innocent person not realising that you go to Canberra and what stays in Canberra, what goes on in Canberra, stays in Canberra. She just started to talk about it, which was a wonderful, truthful moment, which had repercussions.
Well, we should be truthful, Jeremy.
Yeah, but these young people go as advisors, and for heaven's sake, they're, what, 21 and 22? What in God's name people of that age can advise ministers on?
Yes.
I have no idea. But they go and they must see what Janine Haynes saw, which was a complete lack of moral structure. And I guess they just go along with it. I mean, I'm reading between the lines and I'm just following on from what Janine Haynes said to me all those years ago. But I've got no reason to believe that things have changed.
Well, I don't think so. And I agree with you, Jeremy, that Brittany should take responsibility for her poor actions and pay back the taxpayers' money.
Well, if she hadn't been there, it wouldn't have happened.
Yeah. If Wilkinson, you know, gets away with this, it's so irresponsible because she was an editor. She knew the ins and outs of the media, and her falling on her excuse, she didn't know, she just followed what the programmer told her. No, she was an editor, so she should have known better. And to destroy a man's life, it is disgusting. Where is his equality? Where is his rights?
Well, I don't know about Lisa Wilkinson's total experience package, but you're right. She's been in journalism for 45 years or something like that. She was asked about her knowledge of defamation, and she did say that she had never had any instruction or advice on the subject. I find that Very strange. But mind you, along the way, 45 years, you'd pick it up. But then again, to say it wasn't me, it was the producer, or the words were written by someone else, I did note that she took the logie. She should have then immediately handed it on to the person who wrote the words, I would have thought.
Yeah, exactly. I agree. Now, Jeremy, another thing, the SA Parliament's going to introduce legislation demanding drivers to slow down at all breakdown service vehicles like the RAA and...
Yeah, that's been in for a long time. That's been in for a long time.
No, this is going to be legislated, I think.
Well, 25...
down to 25.
Yeah, it's always been 25 Ks if you're passing an emergency services vehicle with its lights on, flashing, I mean.
Well, they are introducing it when the... lights are flashing.
Yeah.
Now, that's
I think,
another...
Maria, they're talking about if a car, you know, a normal average person's car is broken down to change a tyre or something like that. So we're not necessarily only talking about emergency vehicles. We're talking about standard public vehicles at the side of the road. And this morning's paper is talking about vehicles being passed at 100 kilometres per hour. I think that is more the issue they want to legislate. But I think... In tandem, if someone breaks down at the side of the road, a lot of the European cars have in the boot the triangle, reflective triangle, which they put out on the road to warn people that there is a breakdown or a stoppage, particularly on a freeway or a busy road. And I think
Europe on the Autobahn, we still travelled at the same speed. We didn't slow down. I agree that you have to take care, and everyone in the car and on the road and on the breakdown should be safe. But this is another brain fart, really. We are one country. It should be one set of national road rules.
Yes.
What I'm pointing out, here it will be 25. In Victoria, when I travel in Victoria, it's 40. School zones are 40. This law will create more problems. It will be another arsey law, honestly, because interstate drivers, like you said last week, Jeremy, with the fruit fly sign, we don't look at the signs and are reading the signs. We're concentrating on the road. And if that's the case, they will have to inform the whole of Australia that our rules are different. And how much is that going to cost us?
Yep.
Truly, they don't think these things through from A to Z.
No. No, you're right. You have a lovely day, Maria, and thank you for the call.
Okay, then. Same
Bless
to you.
You. Love it too. I do. Les Elikas is with me, and we've got a whole stack of guests. We'll tell you about the lineup in just a couple of moments. I want to talk to you about the front page story that the Advertiser ran. It was more than a front page story. Yeah, well, it was on the front page, but they devoted two pages inside the paper to the subject, to their great credit. Something about consultants. If you listen to my programs over the years, you'll know I worry a bit about consultants and what they charge and, you know, what they actually do when we've got a public service, which is supposed to kind of go out there and do all of these things anyway, because they're already being paid to do it. It makes sense to me. So much happening in the Middle East. I thought I'd ring John Bruni again, Dr. John Bruni from Sage International. the United Nations, Antonio Guterres, who's the Secretary General of the United Nations, or whatever he calls himself, said this morning that the world was on a knife edge. The world, because of the conflict between Iran and all its proxy states and Israel, had put the world on a knife edge. Pretty scary stuff. John Bruni is with me. John, hi.
Hi. How's it going, Jeremy?
Good, good, good. Did you happen to hear that?
Well, I just did.
Well, yeah, that's not quite what I meant.
You hear it first in the dining room table.
Well, yeah, that's right, that's right. Coming to you first. No, look, statements such as these are, you know, common practice for the leader of the United Nations to make. I think that there has to be some form of caution exercised, because really now the ball is in Prime Minister Netanyahu's court. Now, there's been a lot of speculation following on from the Iranian attack that it is almost inevitable that the Israelis will respond in force, possibly proportionally. But let me give you a quick backstory. When I was living and working in the Middle East back in 2006 to 2008, your listeners may remember during that period of time, we were fighting the global war on terrorism. And while I was in Abu Dhabi, there was a lot of noise about, you know, the neocons in the United States under George W. Bush, who were agitating for a major military strike against Iran and its nuclear facilities, egged on by Netanyahu and his right-wing supporters in Israel. So what we're seeing at the moment seems almost a continuation of that same sort of struggle. Now, there are some people out there who suggest that we have Israel has the golden moment now to take Iran down. Iran has demonstrated military capacity, but it has not demonstrated it in a way that makes much sense. Now, they've expended some 300 missiles and drones in a feeble attempt to overwhelm Israel's defenses. Now, the fact of the matter is that Iran is a third world country, and you know, yes, it is true to say that it costs Iran far less in terms of capital to launch an attack using its form of drone warfare assets and missile assets. And it costs the Israelis far, far more in terms of its defense, because it's got all this high-tech stuff, you know, David Sling, Arrow Missile, Iron Dome, you know, this sort of multi-layered thing which actually protected Israel extremely well. But when you do the sums, the average sum put forward with regard to the Israelis is the Iranians, it cost them $250 million to launch its attack. It cost the Israelis $1.5 billion or thereabouts to defend the state of Israel. And you could say, just on naked figures alone, advantage Iran. But hold on a minute. You know, Iran is still a third world economy, and $250 million is not like it is for a rich country like Australia. It's still a big chunk of cash. And we have to also remember 300 missiles and drones being sent across on a fool's errand. They're going to be hard to replace. You know, there is no comparison with regard to Iran and a warlike state as we would understand it to be, like, for instance, you know, Nazi Germany or the Soviet Union. They don't have the factories cranking out in the same sort of manner. So, you know, economics has to be kind of looked at very carefully in this whole situation. You know,
do you mean that there's a possibility that Iran has, in fact, emptied the locker?
It's a distinct possibility, and you have to wonder why they tipped the Israelis off. I mean, if they were really serious about causing damage, they would have said nothing. They would have just let the missiles fly and fall where they land, catching the Israelis by surprise if they were caught by surprise. From a historical analogy perspective, it's like if the Japanese warned the Americans of Pearl Harbor. I mean, why would you do that? You're taking your strategic advantage and handing it over to the enemy. If you really wanted to do damage to Israel, you would have said nothing. So the fact of the matter is that I don't even think the Ayatollahs wanted this to escalate beyond a certain point. They wanted to show the Israelis that they can launch an attack, They didn't want to cause that much damage, knowing full well that the Israelis have the technology and the finances to sustain a major counterstrike.
But surely the Israelis would have realized that if you attack an embassy, you're attacking the sovereign territory of the country involved, and it would have to be a very provocative thing for Israel to do. So they would have assumed, I guess, that there'd be some sort of retaliation.
Yes, and that leads us to what I was mentioning earlier, and we can flesh this out a little bit further. Now, one of the possibilities I've been toying with this whole situation is that this could be the beginning of sucker punching Israel. Now, Israel is known to be very cocksure about its military capabilities in the region. You know, it hasn't been defeated on the battlefield. Well, you know, I mean, there's the 2006 Hezbollah-Israeli war, which kind of worked out to be a technical stalemate, but Israel had not been defeated by a major power. Now, knowing this and knowing they've got, you know, they've got the United States has got their back, certain regional countries have got their back, you know, the UAE, Saudi Arabia, Jordan, they all lent support for the Israeli defense for their own reasons. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, you have to wonder, well, okay, if this is going to be the case, how will the Iranians actually benefit from this? If they are seen to be the victim of Israeli aggression, this will mean that they'll wait until the Israelis overplay their hand, just like they did in Gaza. You know, the Israelis went into Gaza and disproportionately, you know, got their revenge on Hamas, one could make a reasonable case for. The same thing could be with Iran. You know, Netanyahu's always wanted to bash Iran, and they really, you know, came very close to it back in 2006, 2007. So now that they have got this golden opportunity, they've seen how the Iranians can fire off their missiles and drones. They've seen that they're not that effective. Now they'll probably think, rather than wait for Iran to rebuild, why don't we hit them while they're down? And if they go in now, what is the world going to think? You know, the first thing that's going to happen on the Arab street is like, well, the Iranians and also the Iranian street and the Arab street in that sense will be quite similar in their outcome. They'll say the Iranians said this is a limited strike and they don't want to have a follow-on. The Israelis smashed Iran. What kind of problem politically will that cause Israel if they go full in, say, over the weekend or early next week, and blast the crap out of, you know, Iran's nuclear sites, for instance? You know,
disproportionately hit Iran, do you think that that would perhaps bring the Arab countries around the place, who are pretty fractured and pretty divided, as you've just pointed out? Is there a chance that a misstep here could bring these people together?
There is a chance that a misstep here could alter the entire fabric of the Middle East, and not in a way that we expect. What you say, Jeremy, is true, and yet you will have to step back here. The Arab governments are not representative of the Arab people. There is a thing called the Arab Street, which represents public opinion among all Arab capitals. Now, they're very pro-Palestinian, not necessarily pro-American, you know, and they can be swayed in a number of issues at a very visceral level. The governments, on the other hand, are very pragmatic. You know, they will talk the talk of the Arab street when it suits them, but generally speaking, they just don't want to have a war or a conflict with anyone in particular, because they're happy with regime survival. They don't want to tilt the balance one way or the other. They like things as they are. So you will have a division between the Arab street, which will be deeply inflamed by anti-Americanism and anti-Israelism.
Yeah.
And then you will have the governments of the Arab states thinking, oh my God, what are we going to do with all this mess? You know, so they're going to be doing a lot of fancy footwork trying to calm their people down if the Israelis do go in, and go in hard. So I hope that if Netanyahu is surrounded by at least one adult in the room, that if they are planning for a counterstrike, that whatever the counterstrike is, make it very light, make it as limited as what the Iranians had done to them. Mm. Other than that, we can be looking down the barrel of a sustained and awful war breaking out in the Middle East.
Mm. John, Les Elikas here with Jeremy. I have a slightly different slant on it and it's a bit of an amalgam of what you've said this morning. But my theory is that Iran has actually done this strike as almost like a goading tactic. And not necessarily, let's be realistic, they may not have put their full arsenal at play or into play with this, but it's just a goading tactic to flush out what Israel may do, but what also supporters of Israel might do. Because one of the things that's become very evident, and it's been evident for a long time, even before this conflict commenced, is that Israel is seen as a peaceful nation within the region. They're not trying to disturb other countries. They're going about their own thing in a very productive way. Now, this conflict has started, but what has always been evident is that many Arab nations around Israel actually do support Israel and are not frightened about Israel. They are actually more frightened of Iran, because Iran is a hostile country. They've got a hostile administration. They're wanting to take over. And now Iran knows who has come out of the woodwork to support Israel, because certainly the American or the Western alliance has come forward. But Saudi Arabia has offered support. They've been showing what they're doing. Also Qatar has shown what they're prepared to do. So Israel supporters are more now in the front. So Iran also now knows who else might be prepared to support Israel. But it's not just Iran. It might be supporters of Iran in terms of China and Russia. And let's be realistic. From what I understand, Iran is supplying drones which are going into the Ukraine. So it's very conflicted.
It's a rat's nest.
Conflicted. The whole thing's very messy and untidy.
Yeah. Liz, I will agree with you on most of your points. I still think that the possibility, I mean, if there's any potential destabilizing event that takes place, it will be because the Iranians are trying to sucker punch the Israelis into an overreacted counterstrike, because politically that really will change the dynamic. As I pointed out earlier, it'll change everything on the street in Iran, because all of a sudden the Iranian people, who have been steadily going off the Iranian regime for quite some time, if the Israelis were to hit Iran proper, the dynamic between the Ayatollahs and the people of Iran might change to benefit the Ayatollahs, with that whole rally around the flag issue. And we've seen this in wartime Germany during World War II and in wartime Japan as well. So we know that this is a human phenomenon. And I think that if the Ayatollahs had any sense, this is exactly what they would try to do, because they are the weaker party. And you're right, they have this axis of resistance, but one has to also put it into context. The axis of resistance, like Hezbollah and Hamas, they are not marionettes run out of Tehran. The Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps, the IRCG, and the Quds Force, which is the special forces within the IRCG, they do have elements of influence within these proxy groups, like the Houthis in Yemen and so on and so forth. But these proxy groups do what they do to benefit themselves first and foremost. They don't go off and just follow orders like good little soldiers for Iran, because that overcomes one very real thing, and that is that, Iran is Persian and Shia, and many of these axis of resistance groups, minus Hezbollah, which is Shia, are Arab. And these differences make a massive consideration in terms of how close one stands to a particular ally in that particular region. So if you're from the wrong religious denomination and you're the wrong ethnicity, that really depends on just how close you want to get from a strategic perspective. Mm.
Dr. John Bruni is my special guest from Sage International, pointing out that the world is a dangerous place. John, did you see that the Defence Minister, Richard Marles, has announced this new defence strategy for Australia, virtually doubling? I think we spend $50 billion, and we will within 10 years be spending $100 billion on the military. Now, I don't know, is that reprioritizing, or is it shifting expenditure, increasing it? What are we doing? What does he want to do in the next 10 years that we're not doing at the moment?
Let me answer that first. My answer to that is, we're playing a massive amount of catch up on money we haven't spent over a good number of years.
What do you reckon, John?
Look, I think Les is absolutely right. And in answer to your question, I think it's going to be all of the above. You know, I mean, there's going to be money shuffled around. So expect less for social welfare, less for hospitals, less for roads. You know, the Australian economic pie is not what it used to be. And I think that we're going to have to be making, as a people, many hard decisions with regard to national security concerns, because now we are in a different state of affairs. We are now in a world where high-intensity conventional war is a thing, whereas for the last 30-odd years, we weren't in that world. You know, we were in a world of counterinsurgency, you know, where the bad guys were a ragtag group of militiamen out in the middle of the desert somewhere, where they presented as really interesting targets for drones, Western drones. So we had military superiority, and we could strike them at will wherever they were after they did whatever they did to us. Now, with the likes of, you know, Russia having partially immobilized its population and its industries to a war footing, you know, we're fighting a conventional high-intensity war in Europe, which we never thought was going to be a thing, this changes the dynamic internationally completely.
And I think now, for a Prime Minister, John, any subject that deflects away from Australians and their cost of living problems is a wonderful opportunity for Albo and his ministers.
Yeah. Look over there. It's much more interesting.
but gentlemen, there's one thing here, and that is, you're right, but how is this money finally going to be spent? Mm. Now, Australia has a terrible reputation in terms of knowing how and when to spend monies on defence efficiently and effectively. If we were any good at this, we would have been better at this years ago.
Yeah.
So what we're doing is we're taking an imperfect, broken system, and we're going to be shoving it full of money and throwing that broken system forward in the hope that it will somehow repair itself. These systems, these complex systems that we're dealing with and the defense minister is dealing with, they don't repair themselves like that. That's just fiction, right?
But John, surely we can't go on making decisions like that French submarine thing, where we sort of halfway go down that track. And what did it cost us to get out of that? $400 million or something? Nearly half a billion dollars?
Yeah, you know, but then in defense is like a big black hole economically, right? And the thing is that we all know we need it at some visceral level. We need to protect ourselves somehow. And we trust in the experts, right? So the experts being the generals, the admirals, the air marshals, the minister for defense, the political leadership, that they have the national interest at stake.
Yeah.
But defense is a business first and foremost. So there is corruption, there is inefficiency, there are a whole bunch of systemic problems within defense industry itself not been addressed.
But you and I were there that day down at the convention centre when the lengthy process that went on choosing the French submarine was just amazing. Yep. We could have had the American submarine. That was on the table. I remember you talking about that. There was the Japanese alternative, and I think there may have been a Swedish or a German submarine.
That's right.
So we didn't just rush into this French decision. It was considered over a long period of time. And
between factions in the Navy, though, and this is the other thing, you know, everyone in the organisation doesn't speak with one voice. I mean, they have the leadership clique, and the leadership clique comes from beating up other cliques that are rivals within a particular service. And then that thing becomes then the project of choice. So as you rightly say, you know, as we were there witnessing the competitive evaluation process, there were factions within the Navy. There was the Japanese faction, there was the German faction, there was the French faction, and they were having a nice little beat up behind the scenes to see who was going to come out on top of that.
What faction were you in?
Me, I was in the Japanese faction, strangely enough.
I couldn't remember. Yeah. Mm.
No, because I can see a lot of benefit from Australia becoming closer to Japan. Japan is a high-tech power. Yeah. It's in the region. It's not far from Australia. And we're a commodity supplier. So we can provide the raw materials to Japan, and Japan can furnish us with the high-tech methodologies and means by which we can defend ourselves. So I really support that.
But, John, from again, going back to us as taxpayers, we need to know what's going on. And I recall that ever since Mike Rann was a premier, shipbuilding was going to be a marvellous economic boost for South Australia. Since then, we've had two other premiers sprouting the same sort of message, and the taxpayer is still none the wiser about what the hell we're going to do with these submarines.
I
think is one of the biggest problems is that we can have all these toys, but what are they going to actually do?
But we can't even crew them. We don't have enough people in the military. People don't seem to want to go into the military.
Again, gentlemen, absolutely right. I mean, these are fundamental problems that have yet to be addressed. And you can cram defence with another $150 billion per annum, and those questions will still be pushed to the side.
Yeah.
Because the only thing that politicians understand, big ticket items that are built in Australia means jobs, and jobs means votes.
Yeah.
There's no national security imperative here, right? I mean, if you were really wanting to lower the defence budget, buy what you want and protect Australia in an economically efficient manner, you would just go to the American design houses or the Japanese design houses and pick what you want and then import it directly from those countries without having the industrial capacity to produce anything here.
Yeah, just take it off the shelf. Always wonderful to talk to you, John. Thank you very much for your valuable time. I appreciate it.
No problems. Thanks, guys. Thank you. Bye.
Cheers, John.
Bless you. John, he's the sort of consultant. He's the sort of consultant I would employ.
Well, Jeremy, he's got answers and he's got direction in his answers.
And he's got experience and knowledge.
Yeah.
Real knowledge.
And it's not polywaffle.
John Bruni from Sage International. That? Is that Duane Eddy? What was the song called?
Because They're Young.
Because They're Young. Yes, I remember that. God, that's the all-purpose excuse. Les Elikas is with me, and coming up on the program, a remarkable gentleman by the name of Rick. I'll save that. I'll tell you more about that later. David Heath, his life in radio. Johnny Mack, who was a guest on this program going back a little while, Johnny Mack and Peter Clayton have got together. You know, Johnny Mack is 92 years old. He is a marvellous character, and he has, when he met Peter Clayton here, when he was here last time, Peter said, "Would you like to have a look at this song?" And Johnny Mack really liked it. And Johnny Mack hasn't been in the recording studio for a while. And the two of them got together yesterday and recorded this Johnny Mack song. Keep in mind, Johnny Mack has had a career that goes back, I don't know, 60 years or more.
And an encyclopedia of stories.
Oh, wonderful stories. Yeah. People he hasn't met aren't worth meeting.
Unbelievable.
Well, one thing I hope none of us ever has to confront, kind of person we don't want to meet, is a gentleman in a shopping centre or God knows what. It can happen on a street. I remember there was a case in London where there was a guy with a knife on London Bridge and just hacking at passers-by. I mean, the world is a pretty unsafe place to be. But you would think, wouldn't you, that a shopping centre would be about the safest, most benign place you could possibly be on a Saturday afternoon. Well, the events in Sydney at Bondi Junction, Westfield Shopping Centre there, that proves that forever wrong. It might interest you to know that shopping centre, it sort of opened yesterday, but not for trade. It opened for, I think they call it reflection. But it's open today. The retailers can start trading if they want. Westfield management have said to them that the week's rent will be waived, but if they want to open today, they certainly can. Got me thinking about security. Now, I don't know that you can ever be totally secure. A gentleman I used to talk to quite often, he would ring in the program and have his say on this, that, and the other thing. His name is Laurie Bais. And Laurie Bais has a security company, among other things. And I thought I'd ring him up. I'm just trying to figure out how to pronounce the name of your security company. Is it Laurie?
Yes, I'm here. Peritas.
What's the name of the security company?
Peritas.
Peritas.
Yes.
Peritas. What does that mean?
It's great courage.
Oh, great courage. Well, it's exactly what you want from your security people.
Yes, it is.
Must be hard to summon at times, I would think, when confronted by unexpected danger and possibly even death. Now, the question I've got is, security people, are they armed, sort of security people you might see from time to time in a shopping centre, on a railway station? You know, they're not armed.
No.
Why aren't they armed?
Mostly because the legislation in South Australia requires that firearms can only be carried for the protection of assets.
Right.
You can't carry a firearm for the protection of a person.
Why is that?
Because that's the law.
Well, what about protection of people? If you're a security guard, you've got training.
Nope, you're not allowed to use it for protection of people. Now, this is the catch-22. You can only carry a firearm for the protection of assets. You can only use that firearm during a robbery for the protection of people.
Well, that's so crazy. What's more valuable, property or people?
Well, it's partly a problem because of the fact that many years ago, bodyguards used to carry firearms for the purpose of protecting people.
Yeah.
And, of course, this is before the laws were established, and they would get a bit gung-ho. They'd be randomly shooting. And, of course, if you miss your target, that doesn't mean the bullet stops. It keeps going. If you shoot into the air, the bullet comes down somewhere.
Yeah.
And you have no control. There was many years ago a person who had a firearm on a side street, and he shot at an offender, and the offender was running towards Rundle Mall. So that bullet went flying down Rundle Mall. Another one was a bullet down Rundle Street.
Yeah, but shooting somebody running away wouldn't seem to me to be a wise thing to do. But you're carrying a gun to protect people, including yourself. And you'd only discharge that firearm if it was a real and present threat.
You would think so, but unfortunately not everybody in the heat of the moment, in the redness of anxiety, fear, anger, has the right mindset to go, should I or should I shoot?
If you watch television, Laurie, the number of, NCIS people and the rest of them, I don't know how accurate that is to the sort of training that they get and orders that they are given, but you often see them shooting in public places and at cars as they disappear around the corner and all that sort of stuff.
That's America. That's America.
But do you think that happens in America?
Oh, yeah. It definitely happens in America.
Okay, but it doesn't happen here.
No.
Okay, so you can't arm... what about those security people that you see in diminishing numbers, I must admit, delivering the cash, on...
Cash in transit is done in two forms. One cash in transit is the heavily armoured vehicle, huge quantities, and then you've got what we call the undercovers. These are people who walk in normal casual clothes. They usually have a backpack or some sort of bag, quite casual. I personally would often use a Woolworths bag or a Coles, life bag to hide what I was doing. I remember on one occasion $2.5 million cash down to the ANZ in Rundle Mall, ripped jeans, ripped T-shirt, and a backpack.
Yeah, and you were armed at the time?
Nope, absolutely not.
Well, I see. I can't see that that's terribly clever. I would have thought...
No, but the thing is that nobody... Why would anybody think I had $2.5 million worth of cash in my bag with ripped jeans and a ripped T-shirt?
I don't know, but, an ounce of precaution...
Well, the thing is that one of the reasons why crowd controllers don't have guns and knives is that either A, they're not properly trained, or B, what you carry can be taken from you and can be used against you.
Yeah, I get that. What then can you use? Do you have a nightstick? Can you use a nightstick?
Oh, can't use a nightstick either. Or asps, as they're quite often called, which is a expandable baton. Can't use those either.
What about?
Because that is a preclude weapon.
What about pepper spray?
At the moment, we're not allowed to use pepper spray, but the problem when you use a pepper spray, especially in a nightclub, is it doesn't just go in the face of the person you're aiming it at, it goes into the face of everybody in the entire room. And if you use it outside, yes, it will dissipate, but I can tell you there's many people in South Australia who have experienced pepper spray being sprayed at one person, and they're 5 or 6 metres down the road, and the wind's put it straight into their faces.
Laurie, Les Alicus with Jeremy at the dining room table here. It seems to me that with the events that have happened up in Sydney, we need to have a significant review of what our security guards can and can't do and what training they need. It seems to me that it should be reasonable for them to be able to carry a telescopic baton and with appropriate training. Seems to me reasonable that they should be able to wear a protective jacket in case of knife attacks and, again, appropriate training. But also seems to me that security guards have significantly less powers than what the police have, and I particularly refer to powers of arrest. Security guards often get into situations, as you well know, where they need to be able to detain people, and then that becomes an issue legally of taking away people's civil liberties, and hence the law doesn't really want security guards to either handcuff or restrain people or detain people. But I think again, with appropriate training, that should be allowed. And maybe the Westfield situation could have been diffused by an appropriately well-trained security guard with a telescopic baton, and we may have had less loss of lives. And I guess put that back to you, and it's a lot of things there.
There's one of the joys of the security industry is that on one hand we don't have as many powers as police, but on the other hand we don't have any of the bullshit politics that goes with all of that as well. We have laws that we can utilise, such as the Criminal Law Consolidation Act Section 271 or the Summary Offences Act 77 regards trespass, and we can say to a person, you are now banned from this premises, so thinking about nightclubs, hotels, I'm going to ask you to leave. If you do not leave, I can use reasonable force to remove you. And if you escalate, I can detain you and hand you over to the police. Please make your way outside. And we've had to in the past, I personally myself, have had to remove somebody and on a couple of occasions detain somebody until police arrive. Now, because of my years of experience, having worked in the industry for 38 years, I usually call the police in advance, knowing that this person's about to arc up. And so I already know the police are on their way when I'm now giving them the instructions to move out. And, of course, with most venues having cameras, everything is recorded.
Yeah.
So we have to cross the T's, dot the I's, and we're trained to do that. In regards to handcuffs, baton training, that's available, but we're not licensed to use those in South Australia.
Yeah, yeah. Listen,
and that's where part of the problem comes in.
Yeah, Laurie, I'll go on talking to you for a couple of more minutes. Can you hang on for a second?
Absolutely.
I'll just take the 10 o'clock time signal and give you a bit of a weather check. It's nice outside. Let's hope it's nice wherever you happen to be. Stand by for the 10 o'clock time signal, ladies and gentlemen.
You're listening to the Court of Public Opinion with Jeremy Cordeaux, where the time is 10 a.m. Australian Central Standard Time.
Hey! What's the weather for the weekend gonna be? Will it be hot, cold, rain, snow? Ooh.
And the weather today in Adelaide, it will be mostly sunny.
You may not find us on your TV, because in case you did not know, we're being brought to you by, brought to you by,
yeah, and it's not local radio, it's global radio. Professor Ian Plimer is going to be with us in just a couple of seconds. I'm talking to Laurie Bais. That's an interesting name, Laurie. Bais?
If you go back to the 1500s,
yeah,
it was in the old country of Prussia.
Ah.
part of the Tartarian Empire. And then in the 1600s, part of the family moved over to France, yeah. where we established the town of Bais.
Yes.
Built the cathedral. Then during the French Revolution, the family upped up stakes and went off to Germany. The family then split. Half went to Holland, Belgium, and on to Britain, and then across to America. The other half went south to Italy and various other places down south, and also into South Africa. So, my lot left from Holland, Netherlands, over to Australia in the 1970s.
God, you could write a book. What a family tree. You mentioned something interesting earlier, and I'm thinking of not so much an attack in a shopping centre or on a public street or something like that, but a home invasion. Now, you said necessary force. So you're going to use necessary force.
Defend yourself against injury, death, and to defend...
All right. What's the difference between necessary force and reasonable force? After all...
reasonable and necessary are pretty much the same thing. You're only allowed to use as much force as is applicable to detain, stop, and prevent.
But hang on. There you are. In your night gear or nothing, if it's in my case, and you're standing there, and the intruder is right there in front of you, and it's a home invasion, and you've got a baseball bat. Now you've got to run through in your mind. Now I can't hit this guy too hard. You're not going to process this at a time like that. You're going to be in full fight or flight mode, aren't you?
Correct. Absolutely. Now, firstly, do you store your sports gear in your bedroom?
No.
Then don't use a baseball bat. If you are premeditated with a baseball bat, that's considered a weapon of use.
Gee.
And you can't do that.
Well, I remember that some of the schools were complaining there was a home invasion or a spate of home invasions going back a while here in Adelaide. And schools, I was on the air at the time, and a headmaster or somebody rang up, maybe it was a sportsmaster, and complained that every shop he went into, he could not buy a baseball bat.
That's not surprising because everybody's buying baseball bats.
Now, that's premeditated then.
If you don't put them in the right spot, you are then considered premeditated.
Hey, listen, Laurie, why all the good guys have got these rules.
And all the bad guys don't.
The bad guys don't have any rules.
It's the same with firearms. We've had all these firearms removed from the good guys.
Yeah.
But the bad guys don't care about the firearms. In fact, we recall Port Arthur. And what's very interesting is the amount of firearms in Australia registered in Port Arthur at that time is now three times more firearms now in Australia than there was back then.
Well, that worked well, didn't it?
We did legislate a bit better, and we had some new rules and we had some new guidelines. Yeah. But there's more firearms now than what there was then. The issue isn't the firearm. If I leave my shotgun on the porch and people walk past, it's not going to jump up and shoot people. It's the person doing it, not the firearm.
Yes, that's
true. The firearm's not the offence, it's the person. Same with the knife. The knife's not the offence, it's the person holding the knife.
Yes, it's true. And also when people jump to, banning a knife or banning the purchase of a knife or a firearm or whatever, it's not the gun or the knife. It is the schizophrenia. That is the problem.
Only Street many years ago, a guy was chasing another guy.
Yeah.
The guy chasing jumped into a convenience store, grabbed a pair of scissors that was on the counter that the staff member was using for product display, and he then chased that person and murdered them further down the street.
God.
With those scissors.
Remind me not to go into that shop.
Well, no, it's just a pair of scissors. I've seen girls with stilettos and the damage they've done to men's feet or to men's calves with those stilettos is phenomenal.
Oh, God.
We actually confiscated a pair of stilettos, and we'd actually discovered that under the little black cap that's on the stiletto, it had been sharpened to a point. Right? So anything can be a weapon, and, of course, that person was actually charged with premeditation.
Yeah.
Right? So anything can be a weapon.
Don't sharpen your shoes.
Don't have a little flick knife coming out of your shoe. That's premeditated.
Right?
So anything can be a weapon.
Laurie, good to talk to you.
I'm lying in that bed, and I've got that lantern next to my bed. Well, that's reasonable to have the lantern next to my bed, and it's got a little cord on it too. All of a sudden, that becomes a really deadly device for somebody home invading.
Yeah, I remember that. All right, Laurie, good to talk to you. Thank you very much. I'll call on you again.
Thank you, my friend.
I hope not on this subject.
I say too.
Laurie Bais, ladies and gentlemen. Telephone number, if you'd like to ring us, 0491 65 68 60. 0491 65 60 860. And you can send us a text too, if you would like to, on that very subject. It's always a great pleasure to welcome Professor Ian Plimer to this program. To the table, in fact.
To the table.
How are
to
you,
To the
sir?
High table. I just don't sit at any table.
You know, God bless you. I would not expect you to sit at any table. Indeed. Anyway, you haven't been well, but you look fine to me.
Well, I got pneumonia. It's the sort of thing that takes people away at my age. It took my father away.
Yes.
So it's only been, 7 weeks now.
Oh, lordy, lordy. Yeah, I've had pneumonia a couple of times, and it's not a good thing to get.
Pleasant.
It weakens your lungs and your...
Oh, yes, yes.
The whole thing. Well, it's very good of you to come on down.
Well, it's not far.
No. A quick stumble down the street.
Down the street, then I've got to walk uphill back home.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Listeners probably don't know where, but I live, 300 metres away from you?
Yeah, I'm not sure exactly.
Maybe 278?
I'm not... Which number? No, better not tell me that. Yeah. You'll have your fans out the front.
Or people with a lot of bricks.
No, I doubt that. Have you seen all this stuff about the floods in the Arab Emirates, Dubai?
Yes. They have put forward two theories, one of which is highly probable and the other which is highly improbable.
What were they?
And the improbable one is that it was cloud seeding. Well, if it was cloud seeding that did this, it's the most successful cloud seeding we've ever seen in the history of cloud seeding, which has been going on for 70 years now.
Yeah.
And I know the CSIRO put a lot of time and money into cloud seeding using silver
nitrate.
Iodide. And to set up a nucleus for the steam to nucleate on to form a droplet, and then that would gravitationally sink and it would rain. And that, of course, in a dry continent like Australia, is a very sensible bit of research to do.
But it does work?
Well, it has worked, but only on very limited scale, and certainly not to produce the torrential rains that Dubai has suffered. The other possibility is that it was the weather.
Oh, fancy that.
Fancy that. Now, I've been in an adjacent country, and I've worked there 11 times now in Saudi, and I've been there when it rains. And it rains. It's like some of the rain we get in outback Australia, where you'll get a few inches of rain in a couple of hours.
And yet I think of it as a desert, dry, barren...
Oh, yes, yeah, very much so. Yeah. And rain is a very rare thing. So, and none of the infrastructure has catered for heavy rains. Now, we have that situation in Australia. I know a place I go to a lot, a Broken Hill. They have very deep gutters, and when it rains, the council pulls out little bridges that you can walk across from the sidewalk onto the crossing to get across the road. Mm. There's one particular street that goes under a metre or two of water. Just happens to be built on where a watercourse was, and now, of course, there's no soakage, it's only runoff.
Yeah.
So we do in Australia get these absolute torrential rainfall. And you might find that 30 kilometres away they've had no rain.
Yeah,
this is why, listeners, you don't ever sleep in an outback creek, because 30 kilometres away you can get a shower of rain and you can have a wall of water coming down the creek. And I've heard it. You can see these, you can hear these things coming and bouncing in front as foam and logs and dead sheep and things, and the water level will rise a couple of metres in 30 seconds. It's quite incredible.
The climate catastrophiers were saying, and of course the media will always go to the most sensational catastrophier they can find, they were saying, we have not seen rain and floods like this for 75 years.
No, maybe they should go back and look at old newspapers. And we have a service in Australia called Trove, where if you... think, oh, you know, this is the biggest rainfall we've ever, ever had. Go and look at Trove. And the local newspapers will have reported big rain events or high temperatures or long droughts. There are very good records of rainfall. So just because we haven't seen it for 70 years doesn't mean it's due to climate change. And the second thing is that we live in a world of instant sensation and instant catastrophes. If this was 80 years ago, we would have read about it in the newspaper, and we might have read about it 2 weeks after it happened.
Yeah. Yeah.
But now we can have cameras there, and we can see screaming mothers and crying babies, and it makes for good sensational media. And then tomorrow you move on to the next story.
Yeah, it's good to see
with that. No responsibility, no consequences for getting it wrong, no consequences for stirring things up where people don't need to be anxious.
And you know, notice no questions. The media is very compliant.
Well, the questions that should be asked, well, let's have a look at the long-term records.
Yeah.
How often does this happen? Is it cyclical? Do you get these occasional events? What is the weather event that suddenly gave rise to this?
Yeah.
These are questions which people don't ask immediately, whether it's ingrown toenails or heavy rain in Dubai, it's due to climate change.
Yes, yes. There's a narrative there, isn't there?
Oh, yes, of course it is.
Absolute narrative.
Propaganda.
Yeah, but what do they hope to achieve with this?
Universal poverty. We're already seeing it. We're seeing the actual gross household product has been going down in Australia for quite some time, and partly that's due to immigration and partly that's due to the very, very high energy costs and associated inflation. But what we see is then everyone will be equal except for the elites, and that makes it much easier to control people.
Yeah, I've heard that...
This is about control.
I've heard there's also about redistribution of wealth.
Oh, very much so. Redistribution of wealth to those who have never actually invested anything, never taken any risk, never gone broke and picked themselves up and started again.
Exactly.
This is a redistribution of wealth to those who have power, who maybe sit in a room with a couch where they can lie down and gorge themselves, we pay for it.
They've just had an election in the Solomon Islands. And it'll take him a while to sort out exactly who has won. But it's sort of drifting more towards China than Australia. And Australia, of course, is being kind of held to ransom as a gun at our head, saying, you big polluters there in Australia, you're causing our water to rise and our islands to sink. And I'd just love if they did get into bed with China. I'd love them to put that argument to China and tell China to stop burning coal. But they'll tell us...
While the Solomon Islands is carrying on about potential sea level change due to the burning of coal, China has 1,200 coal-fired power stations.
Yeah.
Is building two new ones a week. So tell me, who should you be looking at?
And then they're selling us hand over fist solar panels.
Well, it has never yet been shown that human emissions of carbon dioxide drive global warming.
No.
So you've got to first show that. And then you have to, from that, argue that by making a very, very small change to the emissions of atmospheric carbon dioxide and doing that, you send us broke, that it's worthwhile to do. So we win on argument using fact, which can be checked. We don't win by propaganda. And ultimately, inflation and the lack of employment opportunities, that will hurt. And ultimately people then will say, no, we've gone wrong. Something's gone wrong.
Yeah, but I heard someone, and it went unquestioned. The media didn't sort of say, you know, can you prove it or not? Climate change is set to cost the world GDP $35 trillion within 40 years.
And did they quote what is proposed to be spent to stop that speculated climate change, because the figure is an order of magnitude higher.
Absolutely.
And we hear this about climate deaths. We hear, X number of people have died in heat. Well, when you look at the numbers, and we've got about 34 million deaths that have been dealt with now on this, we find that 90% of climate deaths are due to the cold. No wonder we've got in folklore stories about Jack Frost. No wonder we've got in folklore stories about great famines. Why do people in high-latitude countries go to warmer climates for their holidays? If warmer climates were dangerous and going to kill you, you'd go to the poles for your holidays. You wouldn't go to the Maldives or the Seychelles or somewhere like that.
No, absolutely true. This group of elderly women, I don't know if you saw that, the Older Women for the Climate, they're called. Older Women for the Climate. Now, they've taken the Swiss government to the European Court of Human Rights or whatever. You haven't done enough to cool the planet, they alleged, and God blow me down, the judges agreed.
Well, you have to really question the judges' thinking on that. I lived in Konstanz for a while, which is on the which is in Germany, but on the Swiss-German border. Kreuzlingen is the Swiss town adjacent to it, and I have to say that elderly Swiss women are probably the most boring creatures on planet Earth. And if you can perhaps speed up their demise, you're doing the planet a lot of good. Now, here's a country that is a cold climate country. Here's a country where we have had glaciers retreat, as they do, and they've expanded. We see many expansions and retreats in Switzerland. And when they've retreated, we've found relics of people who walked across the Alps. We found relics of old villages which were covered by advancing ice, and now the ice has retreated. You can see the village. Mm. So Switzerland is one of the type examples to show that we have cyclical climates, that it has cooled and that it's warmed. So these women, I don't know what they're on, but for the judges in a court to make these decisions, to me, demonstrates that the European courts have got nothing to do with justice. They're all about policy, politics and propaganda.
And the United Nations have said, and again...
Well, as soon as you mention the United Nations, I know it's wrong, but keep going.
Yeah, well, they have said... they called a media conference to announce again that at least the last 10 months were the hottest in history, and they've said all of this before, but they were going to have another go at it because they didn't, I guess, figure that they'd got enough media publicity because of it. This March, they went a little bit further. This last March, just gone by, was the hottest March in the last 100,000 years. How would they know that?
Well, you can calculate this, but the problems you've got is that modern measurements are done by an infrared technique. Previously, we did the measurements with a mercury thermometer. Before that, we've used proxies like harvests, like how far north and south people have grown olives. We've looked at tree rings. We've looked at the chemistry of floating organisms to tell us the temperature at the top of the oceans. There are many, many ways of working out the previous temperatures. So what they've done is they've mixed one measurement technique with another one. Mm. That's scientifically invalid.
But they had obviously come to the conclusion from which they were arguing.
Well, of course, but they also didn't look at all of the proxies. Forget the modern measurements. Just look at the proxies. Look at what has happened before we had good measurements, before about 1850. And when you look at all the proxies, we see that in the last 2,000 years, it was warm in the time of Jesus, much warmer than now, warm in Roman and Greek times. Then it cooled down to a period of time called the Dark Ages. And it was dark because you couldn't bloody well see. The atmosphere was full of volcanic dust. In 536 and 535 AD, we had four massive volcanoes fill the atmosphere with dust, we cooled down, we had crop failure, we had starvation, and we entered the Dark Ages. And we came out of those Dark Ages when the sun got a bit more active at about 900 AD, and we had 400 years when it was warm, so warm that we could have two crops a year in Europe. We had so much wealth generated from warm climates, and warm climates do this. People live longer, there's more wealth, there's less warfare, that we were able to spend this excess money on the great cathedrals, the great monasteries and great universities in Europe. Mm-hmm. Then it cooled down into the Little Ice Age. So that's in the last 2,000 years. Before that, we've had cyclical climates up and down, and we were at the warmest period in what is an interglacial some 4,000 years ago. We've been cooling down for 4,000 years. We came out of the interglacial 4,000 years ago. We entered it 14,400 years ago. And before that, we were in a glaciation. And that glaciation was until 116,000 years ago. So we have cyclical climates with temperatures going up and down. We can measure that from ice cores. We can measure it from tree rings. We can measure it from sediments, the chemistry of sediments. We can measure it from the chemistry of floating organisms, which are now fossils. So we've got a very good record of what's happened over the last 100,000 years. And what has happened is temperature's gone up and down. We've gone into a glaciation and we've come out of that glaciation. We're now going back into a glaciation. It'll take a long while before we're there. So by making bland statements that this is the hottest March since 100,000 years ago is demonstrably wrong. It is deliberately trying to scare the horses and it is people shouting loudly because they're not being listened to.
We've got to do all these things by 2050 and all these targets that we've got to, or the sky will fall in, or we'll all die, we'll all perish. What do you think in the next 50 years? What's so magic about 50 years? Hence, I don't know. But what do you think the climate will be like in 50 years' time?
I don't like to speculate, but if we look at the long-term astronomical cycles and solar cycles and orbital cycles, then we will continue to do what we've been doing for the last 50 million years, and that is cool down.
Yeah, and that's a good thing.
Cooling.
That's a good thing.
Well, I don't think so, because, again, when you have cooling, your agriculture is not as efficient.
Yeah.
You have more deaths. You have difficulties in surviving because we have seen every time it's been cold in a glaciation, then we've had warfare.
So the climate is cooling and 50 years is going to be even cooler, which will present its own...
Well, it might be, it might not be, because we're going through cycles.
Yeah, but why are they so frightened? They talk about global warming. I've never heard anyone talk negatively about global cooling.
Well, I'm not frightened of global warming at all. I would welcome it. Bring it on, because when you have warm climates, and remember, we are creatures from the Rift Valley. We are creatures from a warm climate. Whenever we've had a warm climate, we've had a population increase, we've had a huge economic increase, we've had less warfare, we've had greater longevity, we've eaten a lot better, and we are in one of those naturally warm periods. We are doing very well.
Why do you think other people can't sort of put this logic
forward? Well, there are a lot of people presenting the same arguments I do, but the whole scientific community has been captured by the catastrophists, all the scientific journals, the scientific institutions, the research grant organisations, and I wrote about this in a Spectator article that came out last week. And we basically have an industry that is now set up to scare us about warming. It is Jack Frost that takes people away. It's Jack Frost that ruins economies.
Yeah.
It's Jack Frost that actually kills people. So we like in Singapore, we've got all the guns pointing in the wrong direction.
A big mistake.
Yes, I think so.
I'll use that because it's a fundamental mistake, isn't it? Just but a very, very important
this
one.
This is why I keep raising the point. No one has ever demonstrated that human emissions drive global warming.
No.
So we've got the underpinning fundamental wrong, and we've built a house of cards on top of that.
Yeah.
We've built all this renewable industry. We've built the whole net zero industry. We've built the attack on the use of electricity to keep us warm and to eat meals, to eat beef. We've had a complete attack on everything that's taken thousands of years to develop.
Yeah.
And that attack is done by people who have no responsibility. If they get it wrong, they just move on.
Yeah.
And so they're using a scare campaign, using a trace gas, which we can't smell, we can't see it, we can't taste it. It is the gas of life. And
plant food.
It is plant food. And if we continue to sequester carbon dioxide, put it into the ground, then what we're doing is we're taking away plant food. Now, we have a scheme that is put forward to suggest that we should be liquefying this carbon dioxide from coal-fired power stations in Queensland. To liquefy it requires a lot of pressure, and we have to reduce its temperature. Then we pump it down into the precipice sandstone, which is the aquifer in the Great Artesian Basin, to pump this liquid carbon dioxide there. Now, a wonderful scheme, never been done before, but you change the chemistry of the artesian water. But what people haven't remembered was the 21st of August 1986, when there was a gas explosion at Lake Kivu in West Africa, and that was in Cameroon. And one quiet night, we had about 100,000 to 300,000 tonnes of gas leaked out from Lake Kivu, no wind. So this heavier-than-air gas, carbon dioxide, filled the valleys. It killed about 1,700 people who had no air to breathe because the air had been pushed aside.
Good God.
It killed about 3,500 stock. Now, we're wanting to do the same thing. We're wanting to fill the Great Artesian Basin with about the same tonnage of liquid carbon dioxide, and when you convert liquid carbon dioxide into gas, it expands about 300 times its volume, so you get an explosion. So by putting all this liquid carbon dioxide into the aquifer of the Great Artesian Basin, we have the possibility of creating a man-made gas volcano, and gas volcanoes are very common, and we could do the same as we saw at Lake Kivu, where we actually killed people and killed livestock. The solution to that is far, far easier. Don't liquefy it and use all that energy. Don't cool it and use all that energy. Put that carbon dioxide back in the atmosphere where it came from to feed the plants, to feed the crops, and maybe to regrow some of the areas which are being flattened to put in wind turbines in tropical Queensland.
Funny about that. It's, what is it, carbon dioxide is 0.04%.
That's correct. And we get told that we are going to have a trigger point and we're going to have runaway global warming. Now, as a geologist, and especially here in South Australia, we are very much aware that we have a large amount of the Flinders Ranges has got rocks that have got carbon dioxide in them. Only about 48% carbon dioxide is gas, but it's in the solid rock. And those rocks formed when we had an atmosphere that had about 20% carbon dioxide in it. During that period when we had 20% carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, we had four major ice ages. Three of them were when the planet was Snowball Earth, and that's when there was ice at the equator
Good
at sea
God.
Level.
Yeah.
So how in the hell can carbon dioxide drive global warming when in the past we've had massive amounts of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, whereas now we only have trace amounts? So this is a scare campaign. It's not based on anything we know, and it's a campaign deliberately to de-industrialise the Western world.
Yes, I get it.
Because you don't see de-industrialisation going on in China.
No.
Or in India, or in Brazil, or countries that want to use burning of fossil fuels to bring themselves to the same economic standards that we're at.
And we can't see that. Well, they can't see that. We can see it.
A lot of us can see it. I'm sure the listeners can. I mean, you don't get dumb listeners listening to this program.
Hopefully not. But listen, from the past, from which we seem to be incapable of learning anything, there is this I saw this morning. An ex-NASA scientist has warned the cheap satellite, you know, these are Elon Musk Starlink satellites, thousands of them, 5,504 Starlink satellites are now in orbit, and there is a plan to put a hell of a lot more satellites up there, these little tiny, I guess they're about the size of a shoebox, something like that. Now, this is what they say. Particles from these satellites at the end of their life cycle could distort or trap the magnetic field that keeps Earth's atmosphere from escaping. What do you think of that argument?
Well, a number of things. There have been big concerns for a long time about the amount of space junk from rockets and satellites. This is because we are polluting space, and this material sometimes drops to Earth, but there's a great blanket of space junk up there, and we need to know where it is if we're going to push a rocket through it to go to the moon or to Mars or wherever. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that space junk is not magnetic, so it's not affecting the magnetic field. But the Earth's magnetic field is in many ways driven by the sun's magnetic field, which changes. It changes from the edge of the solar system to about Jupiter. And that has been shown by many scientists, Nir Shaviv from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem and a chap from Copenhagen, his name's just slipped my mind, but I last saw him, we were going down in a boat in the Cam River at Cambridge. He's an astrophysicist, and these people have shown that we get bursts of cosmic rays, and the combination of the Earth's magnetic field and the sun's magnetic field stops these cosmic rays coming to Earth.
Yeah.
Now, if we get bombarded by cosmic rays, then we form clouds. These affect the heat balance of the planet very significantly, and we change the climate. And we've known this for a very long period of time, combining isotope chemistry with astrophysics with geology. And so we know that the sun's energy has an effect on climate. Now, if we put a lot of particulate matter there as space debris, then that will affect the incoming solar and cosmic radiation. As we sit here, we get three cosmic particles go through our brain every second, and they continue to go right through the Earth and continue.
Hmm.
But there are other particles that are deflected. High up in the atmosphere, these cosmic particles change nitrogen, and so we get a chemical form of nitrogen which we can trace back in time, showing that we've had these bursts of cosmic energy. So it's a good scare story. The effect on the atmosphere of satellites is very, very small. The effect of a dirty big volcanic eruption is huge. And we've seen that in the past many, many times. The most recent one that had a great effect on humans was 73,000 years ago. And this was the eruption of the Toba volcano in Indonesia. And at that period of time, we had four species of humans living on planet Earth. And these were the Homo sapiens, that's us, although I doubt the sapiens bit. We had the Neanderthals, we had the Hobbits in Indonesia, and we had the upright humans, Homo erectus. We lost three of those humans. We went down to 4,000 breeding pairs of Homo sapiens. That was due to filling the atmosphere with dust from a supervolcano at Toba in Indonesia. Now, we've had supervolcanoes before. We have quite a few of them in Chile. We've got very good relationships between the weather in eastern Australia and Chilean volcanoes. If we had a dirty big supervolcano erupt in Taupo in New Zealand, and we've had many of them in the past, then two things would happen. We would wipe out most of the North Island in New Zealand, which would mean that we would probably win the Bledisloe Cup in the Rugby Union, and that would be a good thing because it's been a long time between drinks. And the second thing is we would go into a period of cooling in the Southern Hemisphere, but not the Northern Hemisphere. But if we have an equatorial volcano like at Toba, you change the whole climate of the planet. Now, we know that. There was Tambora erupted in 1815. And that filled both hemispheres with dust. And that was a period, coming back to Switzerland, where we had Byron and Shelley on a lakeside in Switzerland. And they had a competition to write scare stories. And this is when Frankenstein was written. So that was written in what was called the Year Without the Summer, because of all this volcanic dust in the atmosphere. We don't have that amount of particulate matter from satellite debris.
Right.
We don't have it, and we won't have it for a very long period of time, because a decent supervolcano will put anything from 3,000 to 10,000 cubic kilometres of rock, which is pulverised into dust, and will put that into the atmosphere.
Yeah.
We don't have that volume of satellite material. So it's a good story,
yeah.
And maybe having less left NASA, he wants to
be noticed.
A bit of attention deficit disorder. Maybe that's the reason I'm here.
No, deficit disorder. Well, I tell you what, I'm fascinated to listen to you. You should have your own radio show. You should have your own radio station.
Oh, I just ramble
too
on.
Too much competition.
Too much competition, yeah. Tony reckons.
Well, I can always stagger down the hill here.
Oh, God bless you.
You know, I do a weekly with Rita Panahi on Sky TV. That's at 11 o'clock for those in Eastern Australia, 10:30 for those in Central Australia.
Yeah, absolutely.
Rita has me on once a week. I did one last night from an Argentinian restaurant near the markets in Adelaide.
Yeah.
That was a bit of a challenge to do a television program.
An outside broadcast from a...
No, it was inside.
Inside,
And closed off one of the parts of the restaurant, and I used my iPad. I didn't see the program, but I've had reports that people liked it. It went well. But
I can imagine that.
But it was nice to eat Argentinian beef.
Yep.
And to drink
it was Gauchos, was it?
Yes,
Gauchos. Yep.
Well, they got a good advertisement.
Yeah, yes.
Because I made sure the Gauchos was in the background. Was in their back dining room.
Did you get a discount off the bill?
I don't know. I was a guest of someone else.
Well, I tell you... When you look at all of those things, those uncontrollables like volcanoes, and you look at the methane, I think it's 40% or 42% of the most dangerous greenhouse gas in the world, methane, produced by wetlands and deltas and marshes and things like that. If you looked at that and then you looked at, you know, burning fossil fuels, which one would you be inclined to ban? Not that you can ban... wetlands or volcanoes.
Well, I'm not into banning, but if I had to ban something, I'd ban stupidity.
Good luck with that.
And it's very, very hard to ban because I used to be generous and think that most people had something to contribute, but I've hardened up a bit now. And I think about 90% of people are stupid. Yeah. And that includes your medical practitioner, that includes your dentist, that includes your accountant. That includes all of us. I could be one of those stupid ones. So... I don't think we'll ever be able to stop these sensations where people flap their wings and say the world's going to end.
Oh, yes.
Now, for thousands of years, people have been able to say, oh, the mathematics and science is telling us that the world is going to end.
Yeah.
And we've had hundreds of people doing that. Yeah. Now, if just one of these got it right, we wouldn't be here.
True.
As soon as someone suggests that the world's going to end, then... I think you seal the dog onto them.
Not a bad idea. Not a bad idea. Professor, thank you so much for coming down the hill.
Thank you for having me.
Professor Ian Plimer, ladies and gentlemen. Let me introduce you to a man I've spoken to over the years. Oh, Lord, I don't know how many times. I tended to ring him up every time he won an award or was given the keys to the city or the presidential car or whatever. He is a remarkable fellow, I tell you what. How he got into this business of being a concierge, I have no idea. But he is the best in the world. And he's here in Adelaide. Rick Angeletti, how are you?
Oh, hello, Jeremy. How are you? I'm very well, thank you.
We haven't talked in a long time. But you've been around polishing your skills, and I've been around trying to remember mine. a concierge, you know, how do you say that word? It's a French word, isn't it? A concierge?
Yes, that's correct. Yeah, concierge. Well, Aussie way, concierge.
Yeah.
But you're right, concierge.
Uh-huh. Well, the first time I think I met you or spoke to you was when you were on South Terrace. Now, what was the name of that hotel?
Yes, sir. That was the Park Royal in the 1980s.
Wow, I do remember the Park Royal. Yeah. Is that still there? I don't think so.
Yes, it is. It's still there. I actually went there the other day just because I wanted to. They just did a refurb, and it's another hotel now, but everything came back to me.
Oh, but it's not called the Park Royal.
No, it's called another hotel, Alma.
Oh, Park Royal sounds kind of grand, doesn't it?
Yes, it was.
Yeah, you
it
see,
was very grand.
The thing about hotels and the people who run them, I mean, the really good hoteliers, and you would have met a few in your time, they had a sense of style and occasion. I mean, a hotel was something like, I don't know, an old-fashioned department store,
yes.
Which was, you know, most regal and most...
Absolutely.
Salubrious.
Yes.
I don't know. Now, anyway, I was just reminiscing a second ago about how many awards you've won. How many have you won?
I've received... look, I'm just humble about this, but I will...
Don't be humble.
You.
Be proud.
But, thank you to all the viewers and everyone on your wonderful show. I ran about 8 government awards.
How many?
8.
8. 8.
Yes.
And what did they include? Tell me.
They include SA Great Performer of the Year, the Key of the City of Adelaide, the Gold Medallion Performer of the Year, SA Great, not SA Great, it's the SA Tourism,
yep.
For providing service to South Australia.
Yep.
And the others are just really to do with Employee of the Year of Asia Pacific.
Wow.
When I worked for IHG.
Yeah.
And then just recently I've won Concierge of Australia 2 years ago. And then one more joining this group, I've just won Employee of Australia as well.
And then what's the hotel chain you're with now?
I'm with the Accor group.
Ah, yes.
Yeah, the Sofitel, Pullman, that group.
Big group, international too.
They are, yes. They're very big in Asia Pacific. Not as big in Europe, but big in Asia Pacific. They're huge.
And you've got the key to Adelaide. This is the key to Adelaide that Sher ended up selling on eBay. Did you hear about that? I don't know what she got for it, but it's very cheeky. You win the you're awarded the keys to the city, and you go and sell them. That's
Well, this key's a plaque, and it was given to me by Lord Mayor Steve Condas.
Mm.
Remember Steve?
I do indeed.
Yes, so I was quite privileged and honoured.
How did you get from being, I don't know, I suppose there'd be a lot of concierges or door people, but you turned it into a personality cult.
Yes.
How did you do that?
Oh, yes, that's a very good question. The thing is, I've met so many famous people, and learning from my mentors and learning a bit from all these general managers, as you said, I learnt the skills, the arts, and I just felt like I belonged with this famous guest, and that's how I just got into this passion.
Tell me some of the people that you've met along the way.
Well, thank you. Yes, well, the most important would be the Beatles stars during our wonderful Grand Prix in the 80s.
Yeah.
We had Keith Williams, who owned Hamilton Island.
Oh, yes.
He had George Harrison living on his island.
Yeah.
So here we go, rocking up in a beautiful limo. I opened the door, and I went, yeah, she loves you, yeah. Sorry. But he steps out of the car and then followed down the road by Ringo Starr. It was just wonderful. And that, again, I just felt privileged just by opening a door.
It was a very interesting era, that late 70s, early 80s through to, you know, there was a lot of things going on in Adelaide. You must have been in your absolute element.
Yes. Well, the Park Royal was the 5-star hotel. As you said, we had the velour blue suits. We had the bow ties.
Yeah, you had style, Rick.
We had style. We had fountains in the front. We had lighting. We had silver service. We had everything. It was amazing. And then all of a sudden, Johnny Cash would arrive, B.B. King. We had all the Aussie rock bands. It was just one after the other. It was amazing. I was so proud working there.
Well, look, as I say, you would have been in your absolute element. I don't know if it's ethical for me to ask or for you to tell, but who were the nice ones and who were the nasty ones?
They were all wonderful.
Yeah, they were all wonderful.
They were all wonderful. Look, I was in my teens, then early 20s, and obviously we just looked up to these like gods. We were just such a pleasure having fame. We had to wow them, and we did. We just loved them. It was great.
In all my years sort of talking to famous people, and, you know, you get the would-bes if they could-bes and all of that, but you kind of come to the conclusion that the really big stars, you know, the Bing Crosbys and the Bob Hopes and the John Cashes and
yes.
people like that, they are as nice as anything. And it's only the would-bes if they could be who give you a hard time.
Yes.
Was that your finding as well?
Well, we're in hospitality.
Yeah.
And my role is to make the guests happy, and we did. I wore white gloves. Yeah. I had hats.
Mm.
We had, you know, we cleaned shoes at night. We had to polish the shoes. Mm. We had to do all the, and this is what a hospitality person is. It's just giving the service.
It's also style.
Customer service.
It's also style, you know. It's
yes.
Giving people an experience when they come into your hotel.
Yes. Jeremy, I always wanted to be the best of something. Just something. I just wanted.
Wow.
I found the hotel.
Yeah.
Why can't we have a bit of wow factor carrying a bag or opening a door, smiling? It just it works.
Yep. Well, you've proven that. I mean, maybe you should open a school on the side and teach these people how to do it.
Yes.
Because I do get the feeling, not that I go to a lot of hotels, particularly swanky hotels, but you go to a hotel and you just get the feeling that you're in the way. You're an inconvenience.
Yes.
You're not the most important person in the room.
Mm.
And that's you know, not the way to run that sort of business. How did you get in the business?
Okay, I just left school.
Yeah?
There was an opening at this hotel. I was drawn to it. I had this thing about, just working in hotel. I worked for 2 years, Jeremy, night shift from 11 till 7 in the morning,
mm.
cleaning toilets, vacuuming,
mm.
room service, mm. but I loved it again. And then I grew from that. I went to mornings, afternoons, and then I ended up working 26 years of split shifts. Hindley Street, I worked there for 20 years. How I did that, I don't know.
What was that like? Hindley Street, it was a fairly wild street there for a while.
Yes, it was. I was there in 1990,
yeah.
but we had the Australian cricket team stay with us.
Oh God!
And they were gods in those days.
Yes.
But they still stayed at Hindley Street because we had a wonderful accommodation. We had suites. We had like two rooms, big bathroom, kitchenettes, and they always won their games. As soon as the hotel went to another chain, we've lost them. Yeah, we've lost them.
What was the hotel?
It was the Park Royal for 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Then it became a core property, a Novotel for four.
Mm-hmm.
Then it went to another change to Holiday Inn, which was an IHG, which is an intercontinental group.
Oh, yeah.
And then after 6 years, they turned it into another owner, so a Malaysian owner, which are a beautiful people. Anyone out there, Salamat Pagi. Upper Kabar, that's hello and goodbye. Uh-huh. I learnt their language.
Yeah.
But I had to come to a crown. I wanted to feel a bit more higher level service.
Yeah, yeah. How do you react to people if they give you trouble?
I just look up to them and give them my best. I just keep going. You just don't stop. You don't walk away. You just want to just read their body language, which is the number one in any customer service, is reading their body language.
Mm.
And once you do that and you get that that connection,
yeah,
you will find they will turn slowly. I had a guest yesterday, if you don't mind. He was upset because the Wi-Fi was down. Mm. Now, the staff members are involved with it. They were very upset because he was upset. He was on business. All right, there's no need for that. But I went over there. We gave him a coffee. We gave him a cake. And he just came around today and said, thank you. So that's what you've got to do. I'm sorry. You just got to really wow your guests.
Yeah, but it's sort of like the lubricant to keep the wheels turning smoothly.
That's right.
Yeah. Apart from the Beatles, what's your most memorable moment?
I reckon the Grand Prix, taking the actual Ferrari team. We had the Ferrari team stay with us.
Wow.
And there was a time, when they lost the key to the van. So I had to run, and the pageant was on. I had to run over all these people, call the locksmith, because in those days we didn't have mobiles. He came back to the actual hotel, cut a key, and then I drove the team into the Grand Prix and was fortunate enough to sit in the car. Fantastic.
Yeah, so really what you do is ultimately fix everything. If something goes wrong, you fix it.
Yeah.
I can't just saying that is nothing. I mean, I can't imagine the number of things over the years that you've had to fix.
Jeremy, I'm looking back and I'm just like yourself, listening to you at the moment. I just think, I'm just back in the good days. And thank you. I just like to make people happy. That's me. And look where it's got me. It's got me to where I am. I'm very humble, but I just like to show people the experience and how to go about a job. And when you said you should train, maybe that might come up. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I couldn't think of anyone better than you to run a hotel.
Thank you.
Ever thought about that?
Actually, I think you might have said that on our last chat. Mm. Jeremy, you're right. I just miss that guest contact. I can't. I'm not really sitting down in an office and.
No.
I just like to be out there, and that's me. I've always been a someone who likes the outdoors.
But
leadership role.
But you know, the thing about it is that the manager should not be in Mahogany Row. He should be, as you say, down there with the customers, down there with the people, not isolated from reality, but mixing it with the staff and the customers. Yeah. That's what management should be, whether it's a radio station, a department store, or a hotel.
Yeah. You are spot on.
Ambition, would you, if somebody came along, knocked on your door, how old are you, Rick?
I'm 63.
Oh, you're only a kid.
Oh, you reckon?
Yeah, you're only a kid. But if somebody came and knocked on your door and said, Rick, I've got a spot for you at the Waldorf Astoria.
Yes. Oh, listen to you.
What would you do?
I reckon I would love to take a little holiday first, as I'm planning to do in June.
Yeah.
After 42 years, I'm taking my family overseas to my hometown.
Yeah.
I'll do that, come back, and then give it some thought. I'll have some thought, because I reckon to see the world like I'm going to do a cruise, it might be. Because everyone says we are such in a lucky country. We live in a love, beautiful Australians. And that's what maybe I'll come back. Maybe I'll get that extra service, a customer service role, and go from there.
Where is your hometown?
My hometown's in a region called Umbria. Umbria?
Oh, Umbria, of course. Yes. I've heard. Yes.
Perugia is... the music festival or music state of Italy. I come from a little township from there, which is about an hour's drive, like Victor.
Wow. Yeah. And I bet you it's chocolate box pretty.
Yes, it is. It's one of the most, if you look at it, if you Google it, it's Gubbio, G-U-B-B-I-O. It's the oldest medieval city, well, not oldest, but it's that, medieval look with the walls, the castle. Yeah. They've got the amphitheater. So I'm going to go take my wife on the piazza, and I'm going to renew my marriage, yeah.
Wow. How many kids?
Two, Lucas and Georgia.
Are they coming with you?
Yes, they are.
Ah, that's wonderful.
Yeah, it's going to cost me a fortune, Jeremy.
But why not?
Hey,
why not? A most memorable thing to do.
Oh, yes, indeed.
Yeah. Yeah, well, it's wonderful to renew my acquaintance with you, because I always thought you were just a fantastic guest. And I had the occasion to ring you regularly when you won one of these prizes, so that must have been about eight times, I would think.
That's all right.
As a concierge, do people give you a tip? How do they say thank you to you?
Okay, yes, Jeremy. Yes, they do. Not so much now, because obviously we're coming to a paperless society.
No cash. No.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Paperless. If any guests ask for cash, we don't have it. The banks, even the banks in the mall, they're all closing.
Yeah. Even the armored cars don't have it.
Yes. That's
nothing.
Right.
Can you imagine being a crook in this day and age? Hey, listen, I've got my FBOS machine here.
Yes, that's right.
Put your hands up.
They do. They do. They are overwhelmed, and this is where because they don't get the service. They don't. You go into state. You've got to go beyond the call of duty.
Yeah.
And they really appreciate it.
Mm.
The other day, this lady, she went to the bank, got money to come back and give me some.
I think that's beautiful. No, that's
what are you doing?
No, that's wonderful. That's reward. I mean, reward and incentive are the two great things we've got going in the free enterprise system, and we must never forget that. Yeah. Who's in the hotel? Because you're in the Pullman now.
Yes, that's correct. We're in Hindmarsh Square.
Yeah.
You
featured largely in the COVID thing too. Were you there in those days?
Yes, I definitely was.
Wow.
Wow. Oh, yeah. The guest was saying, I've seen you on TV, I've seen you on Jeremy, we did an amazing job here in this hotel. We united families, we saved people's lives. The management here and the staff, they're still here. We did an amazing job. Wow.
Because back in that time, I was across the square, Hindmarsh Square, at 5AA.
Yes.
And I think looking across at the Pullman, they kind of had it almost not roped off. They had barbed wire, quite barbed wire, but they had cyclone wire. And, God, it must have been a bit like living in a prison for a while.
It was. Once anyone arrived, everything was shut down.
Yeah.
It was called Red Zone.
Yeah.
Everything was manned, police. Security, unbelievable, and everything was sanitized, Jeremy.
Well, if I end up in jail, Rick, I want you to be my warden. I want you to be the governor of the jail. I think that could be fantastic. Who's in the hotel now?
Okay, at the moment, we've got the golf coming.
Oh yeah, the live golf. Yeah, yeah.
Yes, that's coming. So I haven't heard as yet. Everything's sort of, we wait. So I've just heard I'm working Anzac Day.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to be so busy. So all the wonderful people from the Anzacs that come in. I'm so privileged to be here on that day. It's my day off. I'm coming in. I love it.
Even though it's your day off, you're coming in anyway.
Yeah, I'm coming in.
Well,
coming
see, in. Look, I mean, hell, what an employee you would be. What an employer you would be. No wonder you've got all those awards under your belt.
Is it
a full house?
Yes.
Yeah.
We had a memo, an email, sorry, beginning of, the end of March. The staff if anyone required leave, please try to make it another month because we are just flat chat.
Wow.
Yeah.
I think it's probably the nicest expression in the world, whether you are, you know, running a theatre, a restaurant, a radio station, or whatever you like. But a full house sign out the front is a very good sign that you're doing a lot of things right.
Yes, we are.
Yeah, well, looking at your history, I'm not surprised. I tell you what, it's an honour to talk to you again, Rick. Keep me across your career, will you?
Yes. I'll send you a photo when I'm somewhere where I am, when I get to my hometown.
Yeah.
I'll send you a photo.
Well, maybe we can ring you in your hometown you can give us a catch-up on that.
Okay. Well, let's try it. I'll be more than happy to help you and your show.
Tony, can we afford an overseas call? We'll fix that. We've got a bit of credit.
Oh, you're funny.
No, we've got a bit of credit on the studio phone. Anyway, look, I'll tell you what, it is wonderful to talk to you, Rick. Thank you very much, and good luck. And God bless you, and good luck in all you do.
Yeah, thank you so much. I'm really happy to talk to you, and thank you to everyone. And we'll see you soon.
I'd look forward to that.
Yeah, Rick's left the building.
Hey, listen, if Presley was alive today and he ended up as in your hotel, how would you treat him?
Oh, wow. Yeah. I don't know. I'm all shook up.
Whoa. Yeah, look, I understand that. But what about some of these pop stars? I think just to digress, I would imagine some of these pop stars would be difficult. I mean, I've known politicians to stand up in a hotel. I mean, I was in the foyer of the Boulevard Hotel in Sydney when Bob Hawke, he wasn't in Parliament then, but he was the head of the ACTU and soon to be in Parliament, and he stood up in amongst this collection of journalists and screamed at the top of his voice, "Bring me a woman." That's true, absolutely true. And I thought to myself, my God, this man's dead in the water. Come tomorrow, all these journalists will have printed up this story.
Wow.
But no. He was bulletproof. Nothing.
Yes.
Absolutely. But do you have any trouble with celebrities saying, I want a lady of the night?
No.
What would you do if you did?
Do you want me to be honest?
Yes.
Honest? Okay.
Yep.
I can't believe I'm going to say this.
Say it.
Okay, I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
If you buy the advertiser, the back of it, there's a bit of massage. That's where you go.
Don't come to the concierge. The prize winning.
Don't go to the concierge. You know why, Jeremy?
What?
You will find, and I'll be rude, I've gone through this experience.
Mm.
You wake up and your belongings are no longer there.
Ah.
Aha, and then who gets the big problem? I do.
Oh, That's
why you've got to be so careful, sir.
Yeah. Oh, look.
Yeah.
I've not had
go to the advertiser.
Yeah. If I'm in need, I'll remember that.
Okay.
Thank you. Right. Thank you, Rick. God bless you, and we'll talk soon.
See you soon. Bye.
Rick Angeletti, multi award-winning concierge of Australia. And really, the world, because he could go anywhere he liked in the world with all of the luster around his career and just do whatever he liked, wherever he liked to do it. JeremyCordeaux.com is the station, and we are broadcasting to the world. And if you'd like to call us, 0491 65 68 60.
Even go to Spain, come the whole world over, lead her round again. There's nothing can compare with her, I'm glad to say. She's my little baby, and she's here to stay. Cause she's my baby. Please.
The great late Johnny O'Keefe, ladies and gentlemen. Wasn't Rick wonderful? I think he's a fantastic guy. David Heath and his life in radio coming up in just a couple of minutes. Liz, can I ask you a question?
Yes, certainly can. I don't have to answer that.
No pressure. No stress.
No stress. I'm not going to.
Now, this test only has one question. All right? But it's a very important question. By giving an honest answer, you will discover where you stand morally. All right?
I'm listening.
Mm-hmm. A dear friend of mine, Harry Joyner in Melbourne, sent me this. The test features an unlikely, completely fictional situation in which you will have to make a decision. Only you will know the result, so your answer needs to be honest. The situation. You are in Kakadu, to be specific. There is chaos all around, probably caused by climate change, of course. It's a cyclone. Yeah. Chaos all around, caused by a cyclone with severe flooding. The flood is of biblical proportions. You are a photojournalist working for a major newspaper. You are caught in the middle of this epic disaster. The situation is nearly hopeless. You're trying to shoot career-making photos. And there are houses and people and cattle swirling all around you, some disappearing under the water. Horrific, the test. Suddenly you see a man in the water. He is fighting for his life. He is trying not to be taken down with the debris. You move closer. Somehow the man looks familiar. You suddenly realise who it is. It's Anthony Albanese. At the time, we all know it's not going to be easy under Albanese. Okay, it's Anthony Albanese. At the same time, you notice that the raging waters are about to take him under forever. You have two options. Now, you can save the life of Albo, the Australian Prime Minister, or you can shoot a dramatic, prize-winning photo documenting the death of one of the world's most recognised lefties hell-bent on the destruction of Australia. Now, here's the question, and please give an honest answer. Would you select high-contrast colour film or the classic simplicity of black and white?
I think, Jeremy, my answer is in the preamble of the question, which is only I will know the answer, and I think that it'll be R.I.P.
All right, David Heath in a sec. Got a friend, you can listen to the radio. You can listen to the radio, or you can be on the radio, 0491 65 68 60, and you can text us on that same phone number. I can't remember when I first met David Heath. It's a while ago. How are you, David?
Hello.
Are you there, David?
Yes, I am, Jeremy. Hello.
I was saying, I don't know how long we've known each other. I think you were in the 5DN newsroom when I first met you.
No, I never actually worked at 5DN, Jeremy. We met, I think, around the traps at functions over a period of time, but we formally worked together for the first time when the Cruise 1323 was created out of 5AD.
Oh, yes.
At the time of the acquisition, and we took 5AD, that went to the FM band, and the AM frequency for the old 5AD became Cruise 1323, and that's the first time that we formally worked together.
Yeah, well, I noticed in the ratings that came out yesterday, I think, that Cruise, which is a, you know, automated music station, is now the number one AM station in Adelaide.
Indeed it is, and I think I'm correct in saying third overall. So you and I and a few others clearly set that radio station on a successful path.
Well, I sort of, how do I put it, when the accusation, well, I don't know when exactly it was, but when did we go back to calling it 5DN? That's when I was doing the morning program, and it was a little bit difficult because we were doing a talk program 9 to 12 in a sea of music, because the breakfast show was music, and the afternoon and the evening and the drive, that was all music. And people get to know, if you're a talk station and you're a talk person, people tend to go to the station for what you're doing. Music stations attract music lovers, and talk stations attract talk.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
But and that radio station was an interesting mix at the time, particularly in its early weeks and months. Do you recall that as part of the early days of that radio station, you threw together Lionel Williams and Nad Whitcomb?
Yes, I do. They were sort of, what can I say, not old troopers, but they were really professional, experienced people who had a lot to offer. And people knew them from years ago and loved them.
And I was their panel operator, so I had the pleasure of working with both Nan and Lionel. I don't know whether you remember, but just before the radio station launched, Lionel moved home, and as part of the process of moving furniture, he tripped down some back stairs and damaged both his legs.
That's his story.
Both his legs.
Are you sure it wasn't at the Wellington Hotel next door?
Well, he told me it was moving home.
look, it probably would have been. Yeah, no, he was a great guy. I like Lionel Williams. He was the same sort of character in the same sort of era as Kevin Kreese.
Yes.
Who would read our news from time to time. I miss all those old people. You see, I never consider myself old.
No, of course not.
You don't, do you? No, you just sort of move on in life.
No, and it was those folks, Jeremy, yourself, Lionel and Nan and KG and those sorts of folks, particularly from those 5DN, those halcyon 5DN days. That's what got me interested in radio. It was all of those people that I mum listened to, and consequently I listened to as a child, that sparked my interest in radio in my very early days.
What's your earliest memory of radio?
I can remember listening to in my early primary school days. I can remember that mum always had 5DN on the radio, 5DN AM.
Yeah.
And so it was Mel Cameron, who you and I discussed last Friday night. It was you. Was Jan Springett involved in those days?
Yeah, Jan Springett was there, and Nan Whitcomb was there,
yes.
And Ken Dickon was there. KG,
that's right,
had just given up reading gas meters for a living. and took up radio.
It was that era of 5DN which was my earliest memories of radio, and which got me interested. And of course, then I went on to study journalism, and then my first job was as a cadet journalist in the 5AD newsroom.
Yeah, well, I think I was very, very fortunate in being able to own the best music station in Australia and arguably the country, which was 5AD, and a great historic radio station, 5DN. And then being able to put them both together in the same building, and, you know, I don't tend to listen to mix. I never quite understood why a radio station, why you'd buy a radio station. You'd buy a radio station because you really did like the product, like what you were buying. And anyway, the new owner to whom I sold the business immediately changed the names.
Yep.
You know, it's now 5AD FM 102.3 is now called Mix FM.
Yes.
And I remember saying to the guy, why would you change the name and all that history and association and affection? Why would you do that? Oh, well, we have a station in Sydney called Mix.
Yeah.
But, so
it was all about networking, wasn't it?
It was all about networking. So everything, sadly, these days comes out of Sydney. I don't think so much Melbourne, but everything comes out of Sydney. 5AA is owned by Lachlan Murdoch. It's his own private thing, Nova and all of that. But I couldn't believe, because, you know, owning the commercial talk radio station in any city, you only have to look at 2GB or 3AW or 4BC or 6PR, they're all number one by a country mile.
Yes, they are. I have a particular interest in 3AW in Melbourne because I worked there for a little while.
Yeah, I listened to them.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the survey results that came out a couple of days ago clearly show that they've slipped a little bit in a couple of the shifts, but generally 3AW is still way out in front as the number one radio station in Melbourne.
Well, they have made some changes. They've changed the morning and they've changed the afternoon and they've changed the drive and the midnight to dawn. So you've got to expect, I guess, something is going to be reflected in the ratings.
Yeah.
People don't like change.
No, and you and I both know that networking, particularly out of Sydney into Melbourne, has been tried before and it's failed.
Yeah, and I hope it does forever.
Yeah, the fascination for me, and probably you as well, being a radio lover, is what will happen when Kyle and Jackie O start broadcasting into Melbourne. Hugely successful in the Sydney market, of course. But, you just wonder what will happen, because Melbourne people are like us in South Australia. They're pretty parochial about their own town and their own people.
God bless them.
Yeah, indeed.
Yep.
So you just it'll be fascinating to watch whether that works or not.
Well, I'll give you my prediction, then you give me your prediction. Kyle and Jackie O will fail in Melbourne and will fail in Adelaide if they bring her in on Mix. It is Mix, isn't it, that they work for?
Yes. Yeah, if it was introduced in Adelaide, it would be on Mix. So it would be what the shift that Ali Clark currently does, the breakfast shift. I agree with you. Maybe I'm a bit old-fashioned, but I agree with you. I can't, as I said, I've worked in the Melbourne market myself, and I know how passionate and parochial the Melbourne media viewers and radio listeners are in terms of, I mean, are Kyle and Jackie O going to be able to talk about AFL football? The answer is no.
No.
So I agree with you. I don't think it's going to. They'll pick up a few people, but I don't think generally it's going to work.
I love it when people come into Adelaide and they try to embrace the local names, and Theberton becomes the Barton.
Yes, the Barton. Yes, that's the favourite one. Yes.
And all of these little things that you don't know unless you live and eat and breathe and sleep in a city, you just don't really have the legitimacy to broadcast to it. You know, you could do it in Melbourne, and I could do it in Sydney and Adelaide, but you can't. You're just courting disaster if you go into a place where you just don't know the lay of the land.
No, and as we said a couple of minutes ago, it's been proven in the past. Was it 10, 15 years ago when some networking out of Sydney into Melbourne was tried, and it didn't last very long. It failed. I mean, I think it's okay for the Hutchison's Sports Entertainment Network. He clearly networks around the country. I think it works for sport, but you just can't see, despite the massive success and the massive salaries, of course, that Kyle and Jackie O are paid, I just can't see it working in the Melbourne market.
No, radio is local. It's parish pump. It's all of those things that are part and parcel of one-on-one broadcasting. You know,
And I think Les Alicus here, David. I think certain people have an intimacy with their surroundings, and people in Adelaide like to know the local lay of the land, if I can put it that way.
Yep.
And I think people like Nam Whitcomb, having known her, she had a good social conscience. She wanted to educate children. The Thoughts of Narnia was a prized piece of work of hers. And she kept on, you know, the same social conscious path throughout her life.
Mm.
And I think a lot of the identities, particularly like Jeremy's, lover of radio. It's in his blood since his mid-teens, and here he is still doing it and still recognised as being a personality for Adelaide, for us.
Who was it that used to do the nighttime show on 5DN? What was his name? Jeff Medwell, yeah.
Jeff Medwell. Yes.
Now, he was a living legend. My God, he was.
Had a massive following. I used to see Jeff a little bit after he'd retired because he followed the Glenelg Football Club, and I'd see him down at the Glenelg Oval for SANFL matches occasionally.
Yeah.
So, but that was sort of after he retired. But no, Jeff Medwell, when you think of it, Adelaide has over the years produced some incredible names in terms of music. We talk about Cold Chisel and Jimmy Barnes and Hilltop Hoods and Sear and a whole bunch of others. But we've also produced some of this nation's greatest broadcasters. When you talk about people like Jeff Medwell, when you talk about people like Bob Francis,
Mel Cameron,
Jeremy Cordeaux, Bazin Pilko, I mean, they all started. Well, you didn't actually start in Adelaide, but you found your niche in Adelaide. But this town has produced some of the nation's great broadcasters.
One of the great characters of entertainment and radio, of course, radio was entertainment back in the 30s and whatnot, was Roy Reen Mo Mackackie. He came from Adelaide too.
Yes, and there's a statue of Mo on Hindley Street. I think near the corner of Hindley Street and Bank Street. It's been there for some time. But yes, he was also originally from South Australia. I think he lived down the west end of the city.
Yeah.
We did a little bit of this. I can remember when I was in my very early days at 5AD, the radio station celebrated its 50th anniversary, and I was given the task of charting the radio station's history for a couple of on-air documentaries. And we discovered that not only Roy Reen, better known as Mo, was from Adelaide, but the legendary Australian radio play Yes What?
Yes.
Was also a product of Adelaide and South Australia.
And 5AD, that's where they made it.
Yes, absolutely they did. Vaughan Harvey, the legendary Vaughan Harvey, used to tell me that 5AD had an auditorium up on the 10th floor of the advertiser building, and Vaughan would do live shows. He would go into the auditorium and he would do live radio shows.
Yeah, but had a lovely voice. I think he went on to train announcers, didn't he?
Yes, including me. When I first arrived at 5AD as a 20-year-old cadet, they wouldn't allow me on air for 6 months until I'd had some training with the Vaughan. So I had a couple of sessions a week with Vaughan, and he corrected my vowel sounds and taught me how to read news bulletins. And, so I'm a product of Vaughan Harvey. Yeah.
Listen, boy, I tell you, your vowels are wrong.
When I first started in radio, Jeremy, I had surrounding me at the time Vaughan Harvey, Roger Cardwell, Jeff Sunderland, Max Duggan.
Wow.
And a couple of others. And that was my introduction to radio.
Well, they were luminaries. They were fantastic people.
And I just learnt so much from them in those early days. And I also remember how much of a joy it was to work with them because they all got along famously well.
Isn't it interesting that we work in this business where we get up in the morning and I don't make any money out of this broadcast, so it's not a business. But, you know, when you think that other people really struggle to go to work because they really don't like their job, and our business we can work in forever because, number one, we love it, but number two, it's just so damn enjoyable.
Yeah, absolutely. I used to get out of bed at 3 o'clock in the morning. I did breakfast news at 5AD for about 8 years. And the reason that you could get your lazy butt out of bed at that time of the morning was that you just loved what you did.
And you knew if you didn't, there were a queue of people at the door wanting your job.
Yeah, absolutely. That was always one of the little phrases that people would mention. If you worked in radio, never go on leave.
No, you never. Yeah, I've heard that. You never go on. I've been advised that. You never go on leave and you never get sick because, number one, the person who does your program may do it really badly and you'll lose your audience. or number two, do it really well, and you'll lose your job.
Yeah, exactly right. Exactly right. Yes, I can remember being advised about that in my first weeks in radio.
That's why we all work for 2 and 6.
That's right.
And me at the moment for nothing.
Yeah, that's right. But I said to you yesterday that...
Hey, listen, I can't even pay the phone bill.
The lovely thing about what you're doing is, as we discussed on my little community radio show last Friday night, is that you're sitting at your kitchen table or your dinner table, broadcasting every Friday morning. You're doing your podcasts, and you're basically doing exactly what the founders of 5DN did 100 years ago, when radio was basically invented. They were sitting at home in their lounge room broadcasting a radio station.
I'm looking at a picture that Tony found somewhere, which is the very picture that you're describing or talking about. It's a picture of some very large sort of industrial-sized electronic equipment. And at the table on Green Hill Road at Parkside, the beginning of commercial radio broadcasting in Australia. That's a wonderful picture. Tony, where did you get that?
Oh, just off the internet.
Off the internet.
History of 5DN.
Oh, history of 5DN.
Right on Greenville Road, Hume families.
The Hume family, Stella and...
Yep.
Oh, that's wonderful. Well, so what are you doing now? Where can people, great fans of David Heath, tune in and listen to you?
I'm closer to retirement these days than
rubbish.
Sort of anything else.
Never retire!
I know that I can access my superannuation when I turn 60, and that's in about 6 months' time. Last 10 years or so, Jeremy, I've been involved in community radio here in Adelaide.
Yep.
I was at Radio Adelaide for a while, particularly during the tumultuous period when, of course, Radio Adelaide used to be fully funded by the University of Adelaide.
Mm.
That came to an end. So I was at Radio Adelaide in those days when... the University of Adelaide broke ranks with Radio Adelaide. Radio Adelaide continues to survive these days; it's still broadcast.
Is it still on North Terrace?
No, it's broadcast. It was in Cinema Place.
Oh.
It shared studios with Fresh FM for a few years. Cinema Place off Rundle Street East.
Yeah.
These days, I think Radio Adelaide is in a building. Because of the way technology is these days, you basically need a laptop to broadcast a radio station.
Yeah.
I think they're re-established in a building on Greenhill Road.
Yeah.
For the last 5 or 6 years, I've been at the community radio station Radio Italia Uno,
mm-hmm.
which is the Italian community radio station, FM radio station here in Adelaide. Now, I don't speak a word of Italian.
Mm-hmm.
So fortunately, the charter of that radio station is... Italian language programming during the day and English language programming at night.
All you need to do is wave your hands in the air. I'm French.
Pretty
and,
much.
You know, you just...
But the wonderful thing about working at that radio station, Jeremy, is that the studios are in Sturt Street in the city, and it's got a big room out the back where they conduct functions.
Yeah.
And it has a kitchen. And on many Friday nights when I'm there, I do 7 till 9 on Friday nights, when I'm there... Some of the Italian ladies are in the kitchen creating pasta dishes for particular menus they're going to have at functions at the radio station. And naturally, they need my tasting advice. So they
absolutely.
They bring down plate after plate after plate pasta into the studio.
Watch your weight, David. Watch your weight. And you were going. You sort of dabbled a bit in politics. Did you ever really want to take on politics seriously?
I don't think I ever wanted to be a politician. It was after I'd been in Melbourne at 3AW for a while, and it was around the time of the initial election in about 2001, 2002 of Mike Rann.
Yes.
His chief of staff, a gentleman by the name of Stephen Halliday, I had studied with up at McGill.
I know Stephen, yeah.
Yeah, and so I, through Stephen and meeting Mike, I was fortunate to win a job as an evil spin doctor, a media advisor. and so I worked for about 5 or 6 years, I think it was, Jeremy, across different ministers and portfolios, yeah. And it was challenging and interesting at the same time. And then after that period, I'd probably had enough of being because it's literally a 18-hour-a-day job. You've got journalists calling you at 5 in the morning and 10 p.m. at night.
But a media advisor doesn't actually sort of say to the Premier, listen, this is what you should be saying and this is how you should say it. I've never quite known what a media advisor does.
Basically, you're the middleman between your minister or the Premier and the media. So journalists will ring you, hi, Dave, I need the minister to comment on X, Y, and Z. Can you get back to me by 4 p.m.? And so you would sit to whatever the issue was. You would sit down with your minister and probably the chief of staff and a couple of the minister's portfolio advisors.
Yeah.
And you would come up with some lines. And a gentleman like... I've forgotten his name. Isn't that terrible? One of the guys that I worked with, Patrick Conlon.
Oh, yeah.
Patrick Conlon was the sort of guy, I worked with him as a media advisor for a little while. He was the sort of guy that would pick up the phone and he would deal with it himself.
Yes.
Other ministers would want you to send a written response, for instance.
Oh, God. Mike Rann was a very good, able, clever media handler.
Yes.
He was very good on his feet. I remember him. He was always a wonderful guest. We had him on once a week. He knew how to handle the media.
His background included working in the media. He had a brilliant media advisor too, by the name of Jill Bottrell, who
yes, I remember Jill.
Passed away a couple. She sadly passed away a couple of years ago. Did Jill? But Jill was a brilliant media advisor, and they had worked together during his days as opposition leader. So Jill and Mike had been a team for the best part of 15 years. So they knew each other backwards.
He was very good. I really liked Mike Rann. I thought he was very, very good on the ground.
So I moved on, and ever since then I've been working in communications in government departments. So, doing communications and media and PR work in different government departments around the place.
Well, you've survived that and done it extremely well. David, it's wonderful to see you. Well, let's catch up. And thank you for having me on your radio show.
That was a pleasure. And I thoroughly, what was going to be a 10 or 12 minute discussion became a 25 minute chat. So I thoroughly enjoyed that. And as I promised you, we'll need to get you back on because we really only scraped the surface of the Jeremy Cordeaux story. So I really did appreciate that. And it's been a delight to be on your show this morning.
Thank you, David. God bless you.
You too. Thanks, Jeremy.
David Heath, ladies and gentlemen.
We're searching for sunshine. We're looking for a friendly place. A silver lining, a happy face. A little grin in that open space. And a chance to say, have a happy day. Looking for people, the kind who will invite us in, to give a cheer for a home team win, and share a laugh with the kith and kin.
Hello.
And find time to say, have a happy day. We're searching for
We're searching for good times. Well, you don't have to search for good times. They're here, absolutely. Before I introduce you to Johnny Mack, who is in this very, I can't call it the studio, can I? The dining room a little while ago. We had a most wonderful visit with Johnny Mack. He explained to us that he was 92 years of age and he looked about, 50. Just timeless. 21. I would probably believe it. And the stories he told us about show business were just fantastic. But during that visit, he bumped into Peter Clayton. And Peter Clayton is, as you know, if you watch my Facebook postings and the podcastings, you'd know that Peter is a musician and a bloody good one. And I first met him back when I had Decker's Restaurant and... Pete would come in and sit on a stool and play the most wonderful songs and entrance an audience. And he's still doing it. But the two got together outside in the other room out there. It's not quite a green room, is it? No.
No, it's not.
Actually, I don't know why they call those rooms green, but it's not a green room. Anyway, they got together and before we near where we were, Johnny Mac, the great Johnny Mac, the legendary Johnny Mac, was singing a Peter Clayton song.
Yes.
And I got Peter Clayton here at the table, and I have got Johnny Mac on the telephone. Now, this is going to work. We've paid the bill. What did you put on the credit card?
$25.
Oh, $25. That'll see us through. That'll look after this week and next, hopefully. John, are you there?
Yes, Jeremy.
Johnny, wonderful to talk to you again.
Thank you.
Any excuse to get you back, quite frankly. But this song that Pete has written and you have now not only sung but recorded.
Yeah, what do you think? Have you heard it?
Yes, I have. I love it.
Oh, thank you.
No, I love it. Now, when was the last time you were in a recording studio?
Oh, my grandson's got one at Yankalilla, so I'm in and out of them all the time. And it's just what we do. But Pete's version of the song, I didn't think I could come up to his standard.
Ah! Don't and flatter I'm serious. Him. Don't flatter him. He's here. It'll go straight to his head. Because he, like the rest of us, idolise you.
Thank you.
Now the song... the production and the recording, the resulting recording, what did you think?
I loved it, and I'm so pleased that my lawyer son wrote my book. He loves it too, and my daughter Jodie loves it, and she suggested that we do a film clip, and I'll be riding a horse down in the Yankalilla area because I've got a farm at Wattle Flat. Mm-hmm. So we're going to put it to Peter Clayton. We can do a video. I can ride the horse.
Yeah, I'm because here, Johnny, and I like the sound of that.
Yeah, so giddy up.
So at 92, you still ride?
Oh, I can, yes. I have good balance and I can play tennis. And, you know, I mean, I'm lucky to have good genetics and, you know, every day's a bonus. But, I can ride, yeah.
Yeah, but as my doctor said, be careful what you do, Jeremy, because we don't bounce very well at our age.
Would you believe when I met Lorne Green in Sydney,
yeah.
And I love touring with him, and he said, sit down, young fella, we were there. And I couldn't take my eyes off his hair. He had this wig glued on. He was a lovely man.
Lorne Green from Bonanza.
Yeah, it's in my book. And he said to me, now I love him, I love the man. He said, Johnny Mac, when we get to Adelaide, we're doing it at Norwood Oval. He said, I want the quietest horse you've got. I said, why? He said, I can't ride.
Oh, that can't be right. Trotting around the Ponderosa.
No, he said, I can run on a horse, but my stunt double does everything. And he was the nicest man. And I'm not putting him down, but you see, Hollywood is all make-believe.
Yeah, sadly. I don't really want to hear that, Johnny.
Well, they create comic strip characters. I mean, I was there 4 months, and they do a wonderful job in the industry, but you know, the stunt double does everything.
You're telling me it's not real?
Some of it's not real. Yeah.
dear.
Yeah. No, but he was a lovely man, Lorne Green, and he took my long play record back. And did I tell you the story about Donald Campbell tapping me on the shoulder?
No, I don't think so.
I was in the Adelaide airport and I was speaking to Satchmo. We opened for Satchmo briefly in Sault Ste. Marie in the 50s. And I was talking to Satchmo and this guy, I had my record in the 64, pink champagne under my arm. And this guy tapped me on the shoulder and said, oh, Johnny Mac, I like your song, Pink Champagne. And he said, I'm Donald Campbell. I just flew in from Lake Eyre. Mm. And he said, I was lucky to land because my Cessna, we lost an engine. And he said, I was lucky to land. And he said, I like your song. And that was just briefly. I was talking to Satchmo.
Well, lucky to land. He's lucky to be alive.
Yeah. Then he went to Scotland. And he broke the land speed record, but he passed away on the lake in Scotland.
Yeah. Well, you can only push your luck so far.
So it's amazing the people I've met through the record, Jeremy, including Jeremy Cordeaux.
Well, no, I love your record and I've loved your music and your whole history of entertainment for so long. You're a great adornment to South Australia.
But, oh, thank you.
So what are we going to do with the song? Have you guys – yeah, we've got the song. We'll play the song.
We've got it there.
But what have you guys got planned for the song?
Well, we've got to talk about that on Monday, I think. But let's have a listen to it anyway.
Well, number one, I would have imagined that with your history of... I think, correct me if I'm wrong, Johnny, your song, Pink Champagne, was the first and only song to get into the American top 10.
Yeah, country music with a bullet in Cashbox in 1964, and they said both songs should skyrocket, and the Big Sombrero is an infectious Aussie flavour,
yeah.
And it's, the write-ups are in the book, and I didn't go to America because I had a wife and six kids, and I'm 32, and as I said to Jeremy, I've got no regrets.
Well, no, with six kids. Did you say one of them was a lawyer?
No, my son-in-law married my daughter. He's a lawyer, Terry Kavanagh. I just had a coffee with him at the Glenelg, and he just got the last podcast you did with me. I'm very, very thrilled to hear it.
No, well, you are a great guest, and you're more than welcome any time here at the dining room table, because the stories you can tell, and you know where all the bodies are buried. Which is always entertaining.
Well, I'm lucky to have a good recall, and I'm always frightened about getting dementia.
No, that's never going to happen.
But I'll tell you, there's three things about getting old.
Mm-hmm.
Are you listening?
Yep.
First, you start forgetting things.
Yeah.
I can't think of the other two.
somebody told me this, which I think is kind of cute. What I used to do all night now takes me all night to do.
Yeah. Right, every day is a bonus, and you know, don't take life for granted. Just live it to the full. Be kind to people.
Look, I totally agree with you, and I wish you both, Johnny Mac and Peter Clayton, well with this new song, which is called
"Come What May."
Come what may. Let's listen to it. Thank you, Johnny. We'll talk again.
Thanks, Jeremy.
We'll talk again. I know, if you've got the generosity and kindness and time to spare. Yeah.
Anytime. My pleasure. Thanks, Jeremy, and thanks, Peter.
Sometimes I can see myself as a cowboy riding through the Rocky Mountains, dressed up in my buckskins. I got a cabin tucked back in the woods, just to keep my body feeling good. Got a woman with the softest touch to welcome me home. Then again I can see myself on a tropical island, palm trees swaying, Polynesians playing. Take a look at that tamarind, see the beautiful body sway. Feel the gentle breeze on my face as the sun's going down. But the cowboy days are gone, and the islands are an ocean away. Now I got the sweetest girl to love me, come what may. I want to walk in the breaking sun, catch the morning stars on the run. In the mirror of my lover's eyes, the smile tells me we're one. Yeah, the cowboy days are gone, and the islands are an ocean away. Now I got the sweetest girl to love me, come what may.
Anthony Cochrane from the Animal Welfare League. We'll talk to him in a moment. Let me wish you a happy birthday or happy wedding anniversary if you're having a special day. I hope it's an especially nice day. It's April the 19th. And a good day, I hope. It's a Friday. 1770, the British explorer James Cook sights Australia. He writes in his log book, These are the words from Captain Cook's logbook of 1770 on this day, 19th of April. What we have as yet seen of this land appears rather low and not very hilly, and the face of the country is green and woody, but the seashore is all white sand as far as the eye can see. So it was 1770 on this day. Charles Duryea takes the first American-made automotive for a test drive. 1892 on this day. The first American-made automobile went for a test drive on this very day. Actress Mae West found guilty of obscenity and corrupting the morals of youth in a New York stage play which was entitled Sex. Now, back in 1927, that would be pretty outrageous, just the name of the show. She is sentenced to 10 days in prison and fined $500. The resulting publicity launches her fantastic Hollywood career. What do they say? It's an ill wind that doesn't blow somebody some good. I kind of agree with that. Mae West. She was also the woman who discovered the man, Cary Grant. Although he wasn't called Cary Grant back in those days. Archie Roach, I think, was his name. Archie? Yeah, I think so. And when questioned in later years and asked had she discovered Cary Grant, she said, well, at least part of him. Shirley Temple appears in her first feature-length film called Stand Up and Cheer. That was in 1934 on this day. 1995. Oh, yeah, I remember that. The Oklahoma City bombing. Timothy McVeigh sets a truck bomb at Alfred P. Murrah Federal Building, killing 168 people, including 19 children, injuring 500. I think they gave him the death penalty, 1995. Tennis player and champion Andre Agassi, 26, weds actress and model Brooke Shields, 31. I wonder if her mother knew about that. 1997 on this day, which is April the 19th. Here's one for the history books. 1775. This is 5 years after Captain James Cook wrote that little note in his log book when he first sighted Australia. So we go back to 1775, which was 5 years on. The American Revolution begins in Lexington, Massachusetts. The shot heard around the world takes place later that day in Concord. 1775, this day, Paul Revere, William Dawes and Samuel Prescott are captured by British troops riding from Lexington to Concord. Prescott escapes to warn Concord. 1782, John Adams on this day secures Dutch Republican recognition of the United States as an independent government. A house that he purchased in The Hague all those years ago becomes America's first overseas embassy. And I think if you go to, I think if you go to Apple, not that I go to any of those paid television things, because I go home to watch television. I assume for some silly old-fashioned reason it should be free, so I don't pay. As you know from today's program, not even the telephone bill. Is he there? Okay, all right. We got Anthony Cochrane from the Animal Welfare League. How are you, Anthony?
Good, thanks, Jeremy. How are you today?
Oh, I'm young, alive, and a lot of fun.
That's good to hear.
How are the puppies and the pussycats and the rabbits at the Animal Welfare League?
They're patiently waiting for homes, Jeremy.
Yes. I hear that there's a sort of explosion of puppies and kittens, and I don't know why that is. So much so that I heard the suggestion that the de-sexing of animals should be made tax-deductible or free or somehow encouraged.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, we certainly encourage people to desex their pets. It obviously, finances can be a barrier for some people. We'd love to see some discounted desexing out there in the community. We think it'd be fantastic.
Yeah. Anyway, generally, what's the tenancy like at the moment? Are you crowded?
Yeah, we're pretty crowded. We're a bit less crowded than what we were last week or the week before. We've got about 650 animals in care currently.
600. Gee, imagine that. How many times a day do you feed them?
Usually twice. If they need to gain weight, we'll look at increasing that, but usually twice.
That's a lot of feeding.
Yeah, food bill's quite high, I can assure you.
I can imagine. How many people have you got helping?
We have about 100 staff members in total, and then probably 300 volunteers.
And do you have volunteers, or they're all paid people?
So all the volunteers, they totally volunteer their time. They're not paid at all.
Oh, no, well, that's good. I guess I don't. I think people love animals to the point where you'll never be short of volunteers. Because what you do is a very good thing. Have you got a pet of the week?
I do. He's a dog. His name is Eeyore. He's a Great Dane. He's 6 years old. He is currently in foster care because finds the shelter very stressful, very scary.
Uh-huh.
And he spent, before he went to his foster home, he spent some time in our office with me and my colleagues. And we got to know him quite well. And he's a very sweet boy, very sooky.
What's the breed?
Great Dane.
A Great Dane. You could sort of throw a saddle on the Great Dane and go around the block, couldn't you?
Absolutely, yeah. They have been compared to horses.
Yeah. How long has he been in your care?
Not too long. I would say probably 3 or 4 months.
Okay. And describe him. What colour?
So he's blue and white.
Blue and white?
Yeah. So he's just half and half, I would say. Got a blue back, white chest and tummy.
But you don't really mean a blue white. Do you?
Yeah, it's like a light bluey grey.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah.
Good with kids or not?
Not really tested. He's very timid though, so we'd be a little bit cautious around adopting him out to a family with children.
Yeah. How much?
He's 150.
And what's his name?
Eeyore.
Now, I must have seen a picture of Eeyore. Did you send me a picture of Eeyore?
Oh, I might have. I know we went public. We were looking for a good foster home for him, so we put a call out to the public. So you might have seen a photo of him.
I don't know where I saw it, but I remember seeing some sooky pictures of a very large dog.
That sounds like him.
Yeah, well, he's the sort of animal who could wrap you around his little finger.
Absolutely.
Yeah. All righty. De-sexed, pet checked and health checked and everything and ready to go?
Absolutely, yep. De-sexed, vaccinated, health checked, microchipped as well, and our team will obviously provide lots of support.
A bit large for a carry bag, but, you know.
Yes, exactly. But the good news is there's a misconception out there that big dogs like Eeyore need lots of exercise. He does not. He's very lazy.
As soon as you get him home, he'll make himself at home. I think that's the thing dogs do. They automatically know.
Yeah, they'll find the comfiest place to sleep.
Yep, I'm all for that. All right, wonderful. My friend, thank you very much, and my best to all the people at the Animal Welfare League. And just remember, if you are writing out your will or you know somebody who is, just remember to mention or think of the Animal Welfare League and all the wonderful work they do. It's all got to be funded. All got to be funded. Thank you, Anthony.
Thanks, Jeremy. See you later.
Good to talk to you. Thank you very much for being with us. Thank you, Peter Clayton. Liz, thank you. Caroline, Tony, and, of course, Johnny Mack and all our special guests. We'll see you on Monday with the posting on Facebook and the podcast during the week and the live broadcast, jeremycordeaux.com, next Friday, 9 to 12, live streaming from this, which is the dining room table. I'm Jeremy Cordeaux. Believe in yourself and goodbye for now.
We're together, right or wrong. Where you go, I'll tag along. Remember me, I'm the one who'll